A very good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. There are no apologies this morning, and agenda item one today is further consideration of the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Bill at stage two. And I'd ask members to refer to their copy of the bill and to the marshalled list of amendments and groupings for this item. And I welcome Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, and her officials to the meeting. And I remind members that officials are here to assist the Cabinet Secretary during the Stage 2 debate. They're not permitted to participate in the debate, so for this reason, members should not direct any questions to them. So we'll now begin our consideration of amendments. So our first section is consideration of compliance with bail conditions. And I call Amendment 6 in the name of Katie Clark in a group on its own. Katie Clark to move and speak to Amendment 6.
And this amendment follows very neatly on from the discussion we had last week on Amendment 67, which had been put down, apologies, by Colette Stevenson. Sorry, I cleared my throat, apologies. This new Amendment 6 inserts a provision which is an add-on to allow a court to take into account compliance with bail conditions, including electronic monitoring and curfew arrangements. So it would enable the court to take into account compliance with such conditions when sentencing, either to reduce the sentence or indeed to increase it. I believe this is something that the courts already do, and this would simply be codifying perhaps a practice that already takes place where the court will take into account all of the circumstances when considering what an appropriate sentence is in a particular situation. I was sympathetic to Colette Stevenson's amendment to remove Section 5 on consideration of time spent on electronic monitoring, and I'm very aware that electronic monitoring is only imposed where an accused poses a real risk, and therefore, electronic monitoring can be used to avoid remand. So electronic monitoring has never been considered a punishment or indeed a sentence. However, I believe that the approach suggested in this amendment is a better one than was proposed last week, in that it gives more discretion to the court. As I say, I think in reality these matters are issues that the court would take into account. So, for example, if an accused person had not complied with curfew arrangements, had attempted to approach the complainer, or indeed had not complied with electronic monitoring requirements, I think often those would be matters that the court would take into account when considering what an appropriate sentence was for an individual. And at the same time, where an individual has been compliant with requirements from the court, that again, I think often will be something the court would bear in mind when considering sentencing. So I'm putting this forward as an amendment which would give the court more discretion to take into account all of the circumstances.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Would any other members like to come in? Jamie?
Just to indicate to the member, we'd be happy to support the amendment.
Okay, any other members? Okay, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning, Convener. Amendment 6 in the name of Katie Clark seeks to add a new section 203B to the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995. This would enable the court, when passing sentence on a person convicted of an offence, to take account of the person's compliance with any bail conditions imposed upon them while awaiting trial and sentence. That includes compliance with any electronic monitoring and curfew conditions imposed. I understand the intention behind the amendment, but I hope I can explain why it is not necessary. In determining the appropriate sentence to impose on an offender, as Ms Clark has already acknowledged, the court can already take account of all relevant facts and circumstances of the case. In any specific case, the court can ask the prosecutor, the defence or criminal justice social worker how well the accused has abided by the conditions of any bail order to help inform the sentencing decision. Specific provision is not required to enable them to do this. If this new express power is intended to allow the court to consider both compliance and non-compliance with bail, it is also important to remember that breach of bail condition is a criminal offence in itself, which carries a maximum sentence of 12 months imprisonment. Where an offender has been convicted of and sentenced for breaching their bail conditions, or indeed any offence, the prosecutor may, at point of conviction and prior to sentencing, place before the court a schedule of the offender's previous convictions for the purpose of enabling the court to determine an appropriate sentence. This is in accordance with existing powers under the 1995 Act. As such, no specific provision is required to enable the court to take account of the offender's compliance or otherwise with bail conditions, including those relating to curfew or electronic monitoring when deciding on an appropriate sentence for the offender. I note that Ms Clark said in her introductory remarks that there may be, in her view, some benefit to codifying arrangements. My concern is that her amendments have no practical effect and also that they are placed in the wrong part of the 1995 Act. So therefore, I would ask Ms Clark not to press Amendment 6, but if she does, I would ask members to vote against it.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So, Katie Clark to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 6.
Thank you, Convener. And I wouldn't intend to press the amendment today. However, I would be interested in exploring further these issues as the bill progresses and to get a better understanding of why the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Government believe that Section 5 is necessary, particularly given everything that the Cabinet Secretary has said this morning, and whether there is currently the ability for the court already to take into account time spent on electronic monitoring. As I say, I don't plan to press the amendment today. However, I do feel that this is an issue that we need to scrutinise further, and the sentiments that I've expressed today would guide us in terms of our position on this issue. And I think it's fair to say, as a committee, we weren't completely clear where Section 5 had come from, and that is something that if the Cabinet Secretary was able to give more information about as the bill progresses, it would be appreciated.
Thank you very much. So the members indicated that they wish to withdraw the amendment. So does the committee have any objection to the amendment being withdrawn? No. Okay, thank you very much. So I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 37. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Move.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 8 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So we now move on to Section 6, which is release on certain days of the week. And I call Amendment 68 in the name of Russell Finlay, grouped with Amendments 69 and 71. Russell Finlay to move Amendment 68 and speak to all the amendments in the group.
Okay, thank you very much. We've got three amendments in this group, 68, 69 and 71. They relate to the days in which prisoners can be released, although 71, which I'll come to last, serves a slightly different purpose to 68 and 69. Now, the practice of limiting release days already exists by virtue of the Prisoner and Criminal Proceedings Scotland Act 1993, which prevented release on Saturdays, Sundays and bank holidays. And this bill seeks further limits and does so by amending that 1993 Act. It would also prevent release on Fridays and on the days before public holidays. But what's perhaps not obvious from the draft bill is that Thursdays will effectively also become non-release days, although there will be exceptions to that. So if a prisoner's release date happens to fall on a Friday, they will instead be released on a Thursday. But if a prisoner's release date is a Thursday, they will not be released on that day. I don't recall hearing any evidence about ending Thursday release, although the committee did hear concerns about ending Friday release. The Scottish Police Federation, HMIPS and the WISE Group all would rather see improved support services. Now, ending Friday release, whatever your views of it, it does seem slightly unambitious, albeit understandable, but less ambitious still and harder to understand would be to end Thursday release. we should almost just accept a part-time support service. I mean, what the witness has told us is that proper support in relation to medication, housing, benefits in place, that's the key, not necessarily reducing the days. And I suspect that ending Thursday release would require the SPS to significantly change how they work. It will cause potential burden on support services, whether that's criminal justice, social work or people at the WISE group. And narrowing release days will effectively put additional pressure on a struggling system. Even if the motives behind it are well-meaning, it surely increases the likelihood of prisoners not being supported and therefore increasing their risks of reoffending. And if so, ultimately, that might lead to a risk to public safety, which I think is why Amendment number 68 in particular is so important. And I'll be interested to hear the Cabinet Secretary's response to that. Now, Amendment 69 is consequential to 68, so it doesn't need any further explanation. And finally, Amendment 71 should be considered separately to 68 and 69, even if they are not successful. Essentially, 71 is about scrutiny and transparency. It would require the government to publish a review of the impact on proposed new limits to prisoner release days, whatever they might end up being. And given the far-reaching nature of what the bill seeks to do, and given the misgivings we've already heard in evidence, some of which I've already touched on, I can't see why the government would oppose this particular amendment, and would also, yes, it will.
I just wanted a clarification, actually, on 68 and 69. Does that mean that the effect of the amendments would be to revert to the original law on it?
No. It would simply negate the Thursday release element. So we've not sought to amend the Friday release part of the bill.
So in other words, it would isolate the Friday as the committee report really spoke to, but the Friday being the problem. That's the effect of your amendments?
Yeah, just I think it's not been immediately obvious that Thursday's come into play and all the focus has been on the Friday element, which we've heard evidence on, and this is just pointing out that by the back door almost Thursday becomes a non-release day as well, albeit with the conditions I mentioned. So,
thank you.
Yeah. So just turning back to conclude on 71, I'd be keen to get support from that as well. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other members? Jamie.
Thank you. Just in support of these, I think that the only additional point I wanted to make, perhaps before the Cabinet Secretary responds, is we did look at this issue at stage one quite constructively. That there clearly is an identifiable issue of historically prisoners being released on a Friday without access to good and proper public services around them, which I suspect was the reason why we stopped releasing people on a Saturday, Sunday and bank holiday. There simply was a reduced service on many of the public services which people will rely on upon release. I think the concern that we have, which perhaps underlines these amendments, is that if the solution to that problem is not simply to condense the number of days in which someone can be released, I mean, that's a technical solution to the problem, but it's not solving the problem. And the problem itself is that we should be improving access to services upon release, not simply condensing the same volume of people being released, but to a much shorter time scale. And the concern that we've heard about that is it will simply add huge amounts of pressure onto the very public services that we're trying to ensure are delivered to prisoners on release. So social work departments, local authorities and other public services that are already quite overstretched in their capacity, that if they can only do it on, say, a Monday to Wednesday, as opposed to having 5 days to staff these services, that either means a reduced access to service or perhaps some people not getting the due attention that they perhaps need upon release. So I do understand, I think we all understood the government's intention behind it, but putting on do we really need to put on the face of primary legislation in this way? Or could the government have perhaps been a little bit more ambitious in terms of this perhaps being a short-term measure with a view to improve services so that we can use our Monday to Fridays in the due way as they are used by the rest of the wider public? So, we do understand the government's intention behind it, but it seemed like quite a blanket approach to the problem and not necessarily one that will fix the problem either. So one solution may be, if the government's not minded to accept these amendments, is simply to make this a temporary provision and also to make some commitments on the face of the legislation if it's so inclined to either monitor outcomes and indeed take action as a result of that, because what we don't want to see down the line in a couple of years is people simply Wednesday or Thursday being the new Friday and still failing people. That's clearly not an outcome that anybody wants. So I would ask the government to reflect on that as well.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to come in? Okay. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Convener. I am clear, as I know that others have been, that ending scheduled liberations on a Friday or the day before a public holiday is the right thing to do. It will enable more people to access the support that they need on release and support that will keep them and others safe. The policy intent behind Section 6 of the Bill is to increase access to those services, which would include housing, mental health and addiction support and contact with justice social work. So this is common sense. This came from a recommendation, amongst others, from the Drug Deaths Task Force. But let me also be clear to members, this isn't an either-or situation. We also absolutely have to improve out-of-hours access, in particular to addiction services and to family support. So, you know, at the risk of sounding, you know, a bit like a broken record, we really need to be bringing, you know, all the solutions to the table. But this is one practical solution that we, you know, can make and can do so now. It is clear, though, that in adding Fridays and the day before public holidays to the existing list of accepted days, it is clear that more releases will take place on a Thursday. So particularly given, as the member said, that we don't release people currently on a public holiday or at the weekend, so there's already a compressed pressure on Fridays that could then be displaced to Thursdays. And that would place an increased pressure on both community-based services and the prison service on that one day of the week, and would risk undermining the intent of this provision. So to try and mitigate that impact, Section 6 of the Bill also provides that individuals whose release date ordinarily falls on a Thursday will have their release moved to the nearest preceding suitable date. In practice, that would largely mean they would be released on the Wednesday, the day before, although I do appreciate that there would be exceptions to this, and Section 6 does not seek to move any other dates. This was not decided on a whim. It was and is intended to support the underlying principle of this section, which is to enable people to access the services that they need on release from prison to keep our communities safe. So, Convener, taken together, Amendments 60 and 69 would remove that provision, and for the reasons I've outlined, I cannot support these amendments and I would ask Russell Finlay not to press them. Amendment 71 would require Scottish ministers to report annually on the distribution of prison releases across the days of the week. Monitoring, of course, is something that the government acknowledges is important. This amendment would also require Scottish ministers to report on whether services are still being provided by the named bodies listed at Section 34A2 of the Bill to deliver the effective release of prisoners on a Thursday. There are a number of non-Scottish Government amendments on Part 2 of the Bill which call for various reports and reviews, and I agree it will be important to review the impact of those provisions. So therefore, Convener, I am minded to come forward with a Stage 3 amendment which will encompass all the various asks for reviews into different sections of Part 2 to provide a more coherent picture, and I therefore ask Mr Finlay not to press Amendment 71 today. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So, Russell Finlay to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 68.
Right, OK. So the policy intent, the Cabinet Secretary says, is to increase support for those leaving custody. But I think given the lack of evidence we've heard about the specific issue of the Thursday release becoming mostly a non-release day, with the exceptions we've touched on, just seems quite a big step that we're effectively going to have. So, yeah.
Given me, Mr. Findlay, it's just to make clear that Thursday, it would still be a release day for those people who would have been released on a Friday. It's not that we are,
sure.
Or indeed, you know, displacement from the weekend. We're going from 5 release days to 4 release days in the week, just for clarity.
Yeah, well, I mean, but we don't know anything about the numbers who are released on Friday, do we? We've not heard any evidence as to the proportion, typically, who would be released on a Friday, which would therefore now be released on a Thursday. Was that something you would have to hand, or...?
Convener, I'm accepting of the point that we need to monitor all of this going forward, but bodies such as the Drug Desk Task Force, you know, made recommendations which were, you know, accepted by this government, and they looked at a range of evidence in terms of the impact on communities. And I think we're all agreed in terms of the impact of release on a Friday. But we do, in a very practical sense, need to avoid the displacement from a Friday to a Thursday, you know, so that we're not just moving, you know, one set of problems to another day of the week. It's a way of spreading the load over 4 days.
Yeah, I mean, I understand the reasoning. I understand the Drug Desk Task Force have come up with or backed the suggestion of ending Friday release, but I think we're still lacking knowledge about the possible ramifications of this. And I think on that basis, I would push 6 to 8.
So the question is that Amendment 68 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, we are not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote. So all those in favour of the amendment, raise your hands. All those against, raise your hands. Okay, thank you. And there are no abstentions, so the amendment is not agreed. So I call Amendment 69 in the name of Russell Findlay, already debated with Amendment 68. Russell Findlay, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Okay. Thank you. So the question is that Section 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So we now move on to release of short-term prisoners. And I call Amendment 70 in the name of Russell Findlay in a group on its own. Russell Findlay to move and speak to Amendment 70.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 70 seeks to change the way that short-term prisoners are released in Scotland. Currently, every single prisoner sentenced to less than 4 years is automatically released halfway through their sentence with no questions asked, regardless of how badly they may have behaved or the severity of their offence. They're guaranteed not to serve the full sentence, and they will serve half of it at best. Now, in 2015, the First Minister at the time, Nicola Sturgeon, committed to abolishing automatic early release, stating, and I quote, "Our objective remains to end the policy of automatic early release completely as soon as we are able to." Now, 8 years on, and that's still not happened, and with the law only having been changed in relation to long-term offenders. Now, previously, long-term offenders, and that's those serving a sentence of 4 years or more, were automatically released after serving two-thirds of their sentence. However, a long-term prisoner can now be released only if they've served half their sentence and, crucially, been directed for release by the Parole Board for Scotland. Now, what my amendment does is replicate the terminology used for releasing long-term prisoners and matches that for short-term offenders, those serving less than 4 years. And specifically, it states that short-term offenders can only be released from prison once the parole board directs release and after they've served half the sentence at least. There are a whole number of cases I could cite where people who have been automatically released have gone on to commit serious crimes, including murder, and it's not unreasonable to surmise that some of these people would have been deemed unsafe for automatic early release, and therefore members of the public may well have been protected. So this is ultimately about public safety, and I hope the committee agree and the Cabinet Secretary also agrees. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other members? Jamie.
Thank you. I just wanted to add two further points. One is What is clear is that if a judge deems that someone merits a two-year sentence, i.e. 2 years in custody, they will clearly direct a four-year sentence, knowing automatic release will allow them to leave custody after two. Same would be true, I guess, of three-year sentences. They would give them six and know that, as the law currently states, they'd be out after two anyway. So I think there needs to be consideration around the effect, the practicality of the law as it is at the moment. It's unclear as to why there is not parity between short and long-term sentences. And one of the things I think we would have found very helpful, and I was always intrigued by, is what would be the analysis of the data of reoffending for in comparison to sentencing. So I presume there is some form of parabola or gradient which we anecdotally have heard is around the ability to rehabilitate someone within custody. And very, very short-term sentences, the government itself declares that those are, whatever your views on short-term sentences, are in some ways useless and not the best outcome in terms of rehabilitation. There is academic evidence that you need time to rehabilitate, and very short sentences have just as poor outcomes. So I guess it would have been helpful to understand why this cut-off in the way that it has been, and why the promise that was previously given to analyse and change this, if required, has not come to pass. Now, I hope it's nothing to do with our prison population, because the way to reduce the prison population is not simply to empty them through automatic early release. And there are serious questions to be asked as to how much rehabilitation can take place within a very short period of time, say 14 months, for example, of being in custody. This should be evidence and data-led, in my view. And if the statistics show us, and it's unfortunately the committee really struggled to get data on this, that if there is a cohort of people who are released between 12, and say 24 or 36 months, have a higher reoffending rate than those who cross over the line of 50% automatic early release, then surely that's something the government needs to be mindful of. Once again, though, we struggled to get any meaningful data on this. If this bill is all about changes to bail and release, then this is a good opportunity, I think, for the government to either justify the status quo or at least make some commitments to change it as it hitherto did. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Thank you very much. Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I wouldn't be inclined to support this amendment. I mean, Jamie Green and Russell Finlay ask us here to bring forward legislation, or asking the government to bring forward legislation that's based in evidence, which I feel that this is. But then we're presented with amendments like this, which we've not taken any evidence on, and the changes for something like this would be really significant. Could have a massive increase in the prison population, if such, and massive resource implications for the parole board, massive implications about how this would actually work in practice. You'd really need to go back to the drawing board. So for me, this wasn't something that came up.
I'm not sure we should be reticent to make changes like this based on the provision of how well-resourced the parole board is. The parole board will need to be resourced to the level it needs to be resourced in order to meet the legislation that we set. And if this is around public safety or the suitability of a candidate to be released and their likelihood of reoffending after release, that should be the primary consideration, not the effect it might have on how much work the parole board has to do.
I never said that. Parole board was one aspect. Thanks to Jamie Green for his intervention. I never said that. The parole board is one aspect of this. This amendment would be an absolutely massive and sweeping change, and we didn't take evidence on that. I don't think we've had a chance to really consider the implications of it. This is, a policy or a situation that's been in Scotland and I actually believe across the whole UK for a significant period of time, and I think you would really need to be doing a lot more work and a lot more scrutiny to make such a change. I would not be supporting this, Convener.
Thank you very much. Any other members? Bruna McCown, then Pauline.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, I would just echo what my colleague Philip McGregor said, and I don't think Mr Green did respond to his question about the fact that we didn't hear any arguments in support of this during evidence. So I wouldn't be supporting it for that and for other reasons. Thank you. So I think that Jamie Green and Russell Finlay raise really pertinent questions around the sentencing of short-term prisoners, which is 4 years or less. That's the definition, is my understanding. I'm still not too clear about what Russell Finlay's amendment does, and summing up would be helpful. But from what my reading of it is that it requires that every short-term prisoner can only be released on licence if it's recommended by the parole board. So does that change the current arrangement? So every short-term prisoner would need to be released on licence, meaning that if they offended, they go straight back into prison. That's what on licence means, yeah.
Want to come in?
That's my understanding. So bear in mind, short-term prisoners are up to 4 years, so some pretty significant crimes, including violence and sexual violence. Yeah. And if upon release, by virtue of a parole board process, they reoffend, then they would be required to serve the rest of their sentence.
Right. I mean, I'm just trying to understand it. Would you regard that as quite a big change to the system?
Well, it is. I mean, I was going to reference this and summing up, if that would be better to do that then.
Yep.
But yeah.
I thought I'd read these matters now and then give you a chance to sum up, because I mean, I do have a similar concern in that sentencing policy is a massive area of policy, and I just want to be sure what we would be signing up for if we voted for it, because, it's an ongoing topical issue, the automatic release of short-term prisoners or halfway through the sentence. So I really welcome the fact that we brought it to the committee, but I think there needs to be, since we didn't take evidence on it at the time, we'd need to be clear about what the I take Jamie Green's point, and I'll let you intervene in a minute, that well, if we pass it, then it's a matter for the system to resource it properly if we think this is the right principle. I give way to Jamie Green.
It was just to raise the point that there's a massive difference between automatic release and eligibility for release, and I do feel these decisions lie best with the parole board, and I think the premise of this amendment is that people still could be released 50% through their sentence. That's not up for argument, whatever your views on
that
policy.
But it would go through the parole board. Yeah.
But it would be subject to that extra level of test that the parole board would be comfortable. And I do appreciate there will be, you know, implications for the parole board in that, and they may be unhappy with those to an extent. But it does add another level of scrutiny to the process. You know, the automatic. I mean, the you know, someone just walks out the door halfway through, and we feel that there is a knowing what data we do have on reoffending for those prisoners. Then this would add an extra level of check and balance into that release, but they would still be eligible for halfway through, if suitable.
Yeah, I was just trying to understand, but it would mean that every single case would go to the parole board for the parole board to make the final decision, and they would be released on licence in every case. And maybe you want to just give away, if you want, on the point that you made about regarding the parity of short-term and long-term prisoners, not something that I hadn't considered before. You raised it. Maybe perhaps in summing up, I know it was Jamie Green that made that point.
But it's not my amendment, so
I don't know if that's your position, that there should be no difference between the release of short-term. I'm not offering an opinion. I'd just like to know what the rationale for saying there's no difference between short and long-term.
Very quick. Yeah. Okay.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Bring in the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 70, as we've heard, would end automatic early release for short-term prisoners. This would be a significant change to the justice system with associated substantial costs. That level of change requires careful and detailed consultation and consideration. And as much as all debate and all discussion is very important and very welcome, I would state, Convener, that a decision of this magnitude should not be made on the basis of a very short debate at committee at stage two of a bill that is not otherwise dealing with short-term prisoners and when they should be released. I should also inform committee convener that during the consultation to inform the bill that this matter was raised, but there was no settled view on it. And I would also highlight that Scotland is not alone in having a system of automatic early release. It operates in England and Wales and other jurisdictions in one form or another, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't, of course, be debating and scrutinising our own system. Mr Finlay's amendment does raise wider and important issues of who and what prisoners for, and I'm most certainly not dismissing the points raised by Mr Finlay or other members. I do recognise there are very strong views about automatic early release, in that it's, you know, automatic as opposed to earned or assessed. But as other members have acknowledged, sentencing is a massive issue and should always be considered in the round. It might also be helpful for members to be aware, although I'm sure they are, that most short-term sex offenders are released on conditions. I do think that the matters that Mr Finlay has raised, that they, of course, should be discussed, but discussed in more detail and with context. And I don't feel we're able to do that in the time that we have today. Essentially, ending automatic early release would have significant consequences for the justice system and the prison system in particular. It would also have a significant, you know, financial impact, and I'm sure I'm just stating the obvious here for all members. And they're not decisions to be taken lightly. They are deep issues and need to be done with proper discussion and consultation. The short-term prison population is currently close to 2,100 prisoners. Ending automatic early release could substantially increase the proportion of their sentences that these individuals serve, leading to higher prison populations. Just by way of illustration, if short-term prisoners served on average 5/6 of their sentence rather than 1/2, then the population would be expected to rise by almost 1,400. The estimated cost of a prison place is circa £42,000. So this is an unfunded amendment that could lead to additional annual costs of around £59 million. And, you know, I just say this by way of illustration. And there could, of course, potentially be, you know, significant capital costs associated with expanding the prison estate to address any increase in population. As I said, convener, I do want to stress that Mr Finlay has raised important points which do merit further discussion. I do not think, however, that we should be deciding such a fundamental shift in justice policy and practice without full consideration of all the consequences, as there would be, you know, risks in doing so. One that I would point out to is that while Amendment 70 would result in short-term prisoners being released on licence, Amendment 70 makes no provision for how that would work in practice. It makes no provision for what would happen were a released short-term prisoner to breach a condition of their licence. There is no mechanism for Scottish ministers to take any action to address that, as there is for all other prisoners released on licence whose licences can be revoked and who can be recalled to prison. And there are just some examples of why, you know, these are perhaps not matters to be, you know, decided here today. So for all of those reasons, I would ask Mr Finlay not to press Amendment number 70.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So Russell Finlay to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 70.
Thank you. There's quite a lot of points raised. I'll try and cover them off here. So first of all, the Cabinet Secretary acknowledges that there was evidence taken at the consultation stage, and indeed there was a significant amount of evidence support of ending automatic early release. Now, it didn't make it to the final bill, and Fulton McGregor does make a fair point that we've not heard a great deal of evidence in this, and there are, as the Cabinet Secretary also says, potential for not least financial but other consequences to the prison service and others. However, I think Jamie Green is absolutely correct that the parole board is a demand-led service, and given that this was a government commitment 8 years ago, it's if by virtue just of raising this here now puts it back in the agenda and gives us food for thought, then it's probably worthwhile. Going back to Pauline's point about parity, and it's slightly academic anyway, but effectively it would have the same system for long and short term. It wouldn't differentiate, because there are short term prisoners who are extremely dangerous, who know they're automatically going to get out halfway through, whether that's 6 months, a year or whatever, and have gone on to commit serious crimes. And it just gives a mechanism to try and identify those and prevent those from happening. That all said, I think I'm minded not to move it because of all the reasons that have been raised, but I do think it might be worth revisiting at stage three in some way. So thank you.
Thank you very much. So just to confirm, you don't intend pressing this amendment?
Correct.
Thank you. So the members indicated that they wish to withdraw the amendment. Does the committee have any objection to the amendment being withdrawn? No? Okay, thank you very much. So I now call Amendment 71 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 68. Russell Finlay, to move or not move?
Right. Move.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 71 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote. So all those in favour of the amendment, raise your hand. All those against, raise your hand. Are there any abstentions? Thank you. Thank you very much. So the result of the vote is that there were 2 votes for the amendment, 4 votes against the amendment, there were 2 abstentions, therefore the amendment is not agreed. Thank you. So we now move on to release on licence of long-term prisoners. And I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. And I draw members' attention to the procedural information relating to this group as set out in the groupings. So I point out that if Amendment 73 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendments 74, 10 or 75 due to a preemption. If Amendment 74 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 10, again due to preemption. And if Amendment 79 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 80, again due to preemption. So Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 9 and speak to all the amendments in the group. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. Section 7 of the Bill introduces a new temporary release licence for long-term prisoners. The Bill does not name the licence, but the term reintegration licence is used in supporting documentation, so I will use that term here. The reintegration licence is intended to operate in 2 circumstances. The first is in advance of the Parole Board's consideration of a prisoner at the parole qualifying date, the PQD, or at a subsequent review if not released at PQD. In this circumstance, the Scottish Ministers would make the decision to release based on risk assessment and consultation with the Parole Board. The second circumstance is that release can be directed by the Parole Board when they have recommended a prisoner be released on parole at the PQD. The Board can direct that the prisoner be released on reintegration licence in advance of that date. The intention of this provision is to provide opportunity to support the reintegration of certain long-term prisoners. For example, helping them to link to community services and to build a relationship with their supervising officer. And in the circumstances where Scottish Ministers release individual in advance of the Parole Board's consideration of the case, release on this licence provides opportunity for structured testing in the community. This will provide further evidence to the Pro Board to inform their decision-making. Yes.
It was quite a short amendment, and we were trying to get our head around what it did and why. Is the scenario that you're explaining that prior to the Pro Board considering someone's release, Scottish ministers could direct their release and that would be the end of the matter? And in which circumstances would ministers want to release someone earlier than a Pro Board's decision? Because it's not a clear-cut case, the case hasn't been quite made.
OK, so in terms of... I think I've been clear about the parole board's responsibilities in terms of the second scenario in which the reintegration licence could be considered. The first scenario that I outlined would be where Scottish ministers, but Scottish Prison Service, in consultation with the parole board, consider the release of certain prisoners. So there are exclusions of certain prisoners, not based on offence types. So prisoners who are on an extended sentence. This is not for life sentence prisoners. It's not for prisoners who are convicted under prevention of terrorism. And the supporting documentation to the bill also highlighted that quite a small number of prisoners, probably circa 75 to 200, but in essence it's temporary release by the Scottish Prison Service. Convener, the approach that I've outlined prior to Mr Green's intervention was supported by the Chair of the Parole Board, John Watt, when he provided evidence to this committee at Stage 1. I note that Katie Clark's amendments in this group seek to remove the Scottish Minister's ability to release an individual on reintegration licence before their case can be heard by the Parole Board, and I'm sure Ms Clark will outline her reasons for that. I would just like to make a few points in response to Ms Clark's amendment. Firstly, the intention of this licence, as I've said, is to better support the reintegration of long-term prisoners and, critically, to provide structured testing. Prisoners released on this licence will be subject to conditions which will include curfew, which can be electronically monitored, and, importantly, supervision by Justice Social Work. I do appreciate that this is a new licence and there are understandable questions about how it will operate in practice. As members will be aware, this provision will not operate in isolation. Section 712 of the bill requires the Scottish ministers to prepare a statutory operating protocol to underpin the use of this licence. That operating protocol must detail the risk assessment process which will inform release on this licence and the factors taken into account when undertaking these risk assessments. It will also cover matters such as how prisoners will be monitored when released on reintegration licence. In developing this protocol, the Scottish Ministers must consult with a range of stakeholders with specific expertise in this area, and that includes the Risk Management Authority and, as I mentioned earlier, the Independent Parole Board. I hope that provides suitable reassurance to Ms Clark and that she recognises the importance of having the opportunity to test prisoners before the release, subject to risk assessments, as I have described. Turning specifically to Amendment 73 for a moment, this amendment would remove the legal considerations which Scottish Ministers and the Parole Board must have regard to when releasing a prisoner on a reintegration licence. And I'm not clear what the purpose of this amendment is. I note that Ms Clark's view appears to be that the Scottish Ministers should not be making these decisions, but Amendment 73 would remove those legal considerations in cases where the Parole Board directs release on a reintegration licence. I do not support the view that Scottish Ministers should not be able to release prisoners on this licence within the parameters described in the bill. I do recognise that this will need to be done on the basis of clear risk assessment, which takes account of all relevant factors, and the bill provides for this. And I would therefore ask Ms Clark not to move for amendments in this group. Turning to Mr Green's amendments, Amendment 75 seeks to add the protection of the victim or victims of the prisoner or a class of person to whom the prisoner may pose a risk if released on this licence to the existing list of considerations which the Scottish Ministers and the Parole Board must have regard to before releasing a prisoner on this licence. The bill currently lists those considerations as protection of the public at large, or reducing reoffending and supporting the reintegration of the prisoner. Victim safety would be included in the definition of protection of the public at large, but I appreciate that it would be helpful to put that beyond doubt. Therefore, I will commit to bringing forward a Stage 3 amendment which would address the issue of victim safety as one of the legal considerations which the Scottish Ministers and the Parole Board must have regard to when deciding to release on this licence. The Parole Board will, of course, have already taken account of victim safety concerns when deciding to recommend release on parole licence. And I would therefore ask Jamie Green not to move Amendment 75, but more than happy to engage with him further on these matters. Turning to Amendment 80, also lodged by Jamie Green, this amendment seeks to add individuals who are subject to the sexual offences notification requirements to the list of statutory exclusions from release by the Scottish Ministers on this licence. The list of existing statutory inclusions within the bill does not include offence-focused exclusions, and that was deliberate. It was based on feedback received during the consultation and from stakeholders that decisions about release should be based on risk assessment and not on the basis of offence type alone. And I know that Mark McSherry, Chief Executive of the Risk Management Authority, made a similar point when he provided evidence to the committee during Stage 1. Mr McSherry said, "My point is that we need to understand the pattern, nature, seriousness and likelihood of such behaviours so that we develop a proportionate response that adequately protects victims and addresses the specific risk that is identified when we use broad offence categories that sometimes does not allow us to understand the risk that specific individuals might pose within broad spectrums. Therefore, our view is that the level of understanding, that this level of risk assessment understanding is required. And as I've highlighted, convener, this provision has been designed with risk assessment at its core. The risk posed by all individuals being considered for this licence will be carefully assessed as part of that risk assessment process, regardless of the offence that they have been convicted of. Statutory exclusions on the basis of offence type alone cut across that. It might be of interest for Mr Green to know that for those people who are given an extended sentence, that they are excluded from, as I said earlier, from being eligible to be considered from the reintegration licence. And if you look at figures over the piece, the majority of people who are given an extended sentence are sex offenders. So for the reasons outlined above, convener, I would ask Mr Green not to press this amendment. Turning finally to my amendments 9 and 10, these are both technical amendments. Amendment 9 repeals subsection 7 of section 3AA of the Prisoner and Criminal Proceedings Scotland Act 1993. The subsection relates to the Parole Board's decision making in relation to the long-term prisoners on home detention curfew. Section 7 of this bill removes long-term prisoners from home detention curfew, so this subsection is no longer required. Amendment 10 corrects a minor drafting error at introduction where the wrong subsection number was used, and I move Amendment 9 in my name, convener.
Thank you very much. So I now call Katie Clark to speak to Amendment 72 and other amendments in the group.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and I speak to Amendment 72 and the consequential amendments put down in my name, which seek to remove Section 753AB, subsections 1 and 2, relating to further powers to release long-term prisoners. Although the committee considered some evidence in relation to these proposals, I think it's fair to say that other aspects of the bill received greater scrutiny. And I think we would want to have a far better understanding of what the implications of these provisions would be if passed. It has to be said that there have been numerous concerns expressed by victims' organisations, in particular Victim Support Scotland, but other organisations about the implications of these provisions. It's unclear why the Scottish Government feels these provisions are necessary, and I've listened very carefully to what the Cabinet Secretary has said and the explanation as to why the Scottish Government have included these proposals, and I look forward to having sight of the Government amendment on victims' safety, because many of the concerns being expressed relate to victims. And Amendment 75, put down in the name of Jamie Green, I believe also reflects some of the concerns and attempts to address some of the concerns that have been made. My amendments would take out the provisions which in essence permit Scottish ministers to release long-term prisoners after 80 days before the prisoner's parole qualifying date, provided the parole board had not recommended the prisoner be released on licence. And the amendments are put down as probing amendments, but also on the basis that these provisions from the government are overreach. We'll listen very carefully to what the Cabinet Secretary has to say, but I would be interested to hear what engagement there's been with Victim Support Scotland and other organisations who are expressing detailed concerns about the implications of the legislation and what attempts are being made to ensure that the genuine concerns being raised are addressed. And this may be an issue that we'd come back to at a later stage.
Thank you very much. So I now call Jamie Green to speak to Amendment 75 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Can I start with Amendment 9, which is the opening amendment in this group, in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? As I said in my intervention, we were unsure as to the technical outcome of repealing subsection 7 as it's listed. And I listened carefully to the points the Cabinet Secretary made, but well, I either not fully understanding the scenario or not convinced by it. I'm not sure which at the moment. But effectively, my understanding is that when we use, and it's a byproduct of how you legislate, but when we talk about Scottish ministers, the Cabinet Secretary talked a lot about the SPS, but who would make those decisions as opposed to Scottish ministers. I think there's a big difference. There's a lot of discussion at the moment around this whole section. Section 7 is around powers that ministers might have or not have in relation to interventions. I think there's a. I think we need to be quite clear with people when we talk about this issue. A decision made by a minister may be done for very different reasons to one, that, for example, that's made by the prison service, and by that could be either. And we don't know who in the prison service would make such a decision. Is there a committee of the SPS who would decide this matter? Would it be up to individual governors who are employed by the SPS? In which case, you could argue that this amendment gives governors more autonomy, for example, in what happens to their prison cohort, knowing that they understand the prisoners within their own institution. You could argue that sounds like an eminently sensible thing to do. But equally, there are prisons that are not operated by the SPS but may fall under their wider remit. So there are questions there as well. So I think that there is a big difference between giving ministers a power to override, overrule, preempt decisions made by independent bodies like the parole board and other decisions that governors might want to make. And I'm not convinced that the case has been made for the government to have the need of this power. If we end up in a scenario where a government minister directs the release of someone, but there's unhappiness around that decision, either within the prison itself, the SPS, or the parole board have reservations about it, whether the release would go ahead anyway and whether there would be any ability to stop or appeal that decision. Again, that's not really covered because this amendment just has quite a blanket approach to that scenario. So I don't think it's something that we really fully went into as a committee, and it's unfortunate because I think there may be some merit in what the Cabinet Secretary is trying to say and why this power might be helpful in some scenarios. But 75-200 prisons doesn't sound a lot, but it would be a lot if they went out and committed further offences, or if there are people that the parole board said they might not be suitable for release, but ministers want to do it anyway, and it's unsure as to why ministers would ever want to do that. So again, if we'd had some evidence on this and we talked about it at stage one, then we may have been more convinced. So for that reason, be inclined not to support 9. I'll turn to my own amendments. They're largely fall into two groups. 75 and 80 seek to strengthen the consideration of victims throughout this process. And there's a more blanket amendment at 89, which I'll come on to in a second. I do welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments. I won't go into great detail selling the amendment to the committee, but it was an amendment that was strongly supported by Victim Support Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid and Assist, and members will note the paper that they sent to us yesterday arguing amendments that we were debating today that they do not support or strongly support, and I'm pleased that this is one that they strongly support. I understand that, as is often the case, members draft things in a certain way. The government's happy to look at that, and I would very much welcome that. I'd be happy to work with the Cabinet Secretary on looking at how, in addition to the existing statutory protections, which go beyond protecting the public at large, as is currently drafted in the bill, that if there could be any strengthening of that to include victims, I'd be very, very much welcome that. Amendment 80, though, that we may have some disagreement. I think Amendment 80, again, this is another short amendment which is strongly supported by Victim Support Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid and Assist, I think for good reason. And I think that's because I understand the argument made around listing offences. But this whole section ultimately is around ministers releasing people. In fact, it says in line 15 exactly what it does. Scottish ministers may release on licence a long-term prisoner whose release has not been recommended by the parole board. And I think that's the wider issue. We can't forget what this whole section is about. It's an additional power that currently doesn't exist. Now, you may have a wider view on whether the government should have this power or not, but if the government must have this power and it's clearly the direction of travel, then all we can do is add in some safeguards. Amendment 80 does exactly that by the introduction of a prohibition of release of someone who, for example, is on the sex offenders register, but specifically where the parole board has not directed the release of that prisoner. So we talk about risk assessment, as the Cabinet Secretary did. I believe that the parole board go through that process robustly. Not everyone always agrees with the outcome of that, and there is a process for that. But surely that is where risk assessment best happens, at the independent arm's length situation of a parole board. It's hard to see how there can be true risk assessment if the parole board are not involved. And then specifically around cases where someone has been convicted of a specific sex offence, where there may be greater risk to a victim upon their release, I do not believe that the government should hold the power to release that individual. And therefore, the current prohibition which exists, which is being removed by this bill, I would like to reintroduce back into the bill. And I believe that's why it's been supported by victims' organisations. So I'll leave my comments at that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to come in? No? OK. Cabinet Secretary, to wind up.
Just to briefly say, Convener, that risk assessment is at the core of these provisions, and actually for all offence types. And I think there are risks of, if we start, including or excluding, you know, some offences. I think, given that this is for long-term prisoners, that the thorough risk assessment procedure should be applied to all prisoners that are being considered. And, of course, it's been considered. There is no automatic entitlement to be released on this temporary reintegration licence. Within the provisions, there is a very, you know, clear commitment that the parole board and the risk management authority have to be consulted for those prisoners that the Scottish ministers would be considering release for. I do appreciate that the language of legislation can be confusing, and particularly in terms of who and what Scottish ministers are, because in some scenarios that means Scottish ministers, in other scenarios, in this case, it actually means the Scottish Prison Service, and that's to do with the nature of them being an executive agency. Yep.
Thank you very much. I have to confess, some of this is technical, trying to follow all the dots and comments. You'd appreciate that, of which prisons are excluded and who has the powers to do it. But I don't know if you addressed to what extent why you want to do it. What's the philosophy behind it? I mean, I did read the purpose and effect amendment, which is quite thorough. So, but I'm still, what's the philosophy behind it? Is it because you think it's time to change the way we do things, releasing prisoners? Is it time to change giving certain prisoners the opportunity to see if, or is there another reason? It's the why question that I'm still struggling with a little bit.
So it is clear about who's excluded, and I covered that earlier in my answer to Mr. Green, but this, and I'm sure committee may have heard evidence on this from the parole board, is that very often when people are coming up for consideration of parole for the first time, that often there's just not enough evidence because people have not been tested enough. Hence, you know, the logic for some prisoners to be tested on a temporary release licence. I wanted to end my comments, convener, on really stressing to committee the importance of the statutory operating procedure. And firstly, to give assurance to committee that this is something that I will be paying particularly close attention to, and that I would be more than happy to be having discussions with members to ensure that they are, you know, fully cited on our thinking in and around the statutory operating procedure, because you know, the scope of that is absolutely crucial. And in terms of victim support organisations, we will indeed you know, have very close engagement with victim support organisations over the statutory operating procedure. So thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So the question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed, therefore we will go to a vote. So all those in favour of Amendment 9, please raise your hands. All those against, raise your hands. All those abstaining, raise your hands. Thank you. So we have 4 votes in support of the amendment, 2 votes against the amendment, and 2 abstentions. Therefore, the amendment is agreed to. So I call Amendment 72 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark, to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. I call Amendment 73 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 74 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark, to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. Just apologies, members, just making sure I'm at the right point. Thank you. I call Amendment 10 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 9. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 75 in the name of Jamie Green. Already debated with Amendment 9. Jamie Green to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 76 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 77 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 78 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 79 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 80 in the name of Jamie Green, already debated with Amendment 9. Jamie Green to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 80 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, we are not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote. So all those in favour of the amendment, please raise your hands. Thank you. All those against, raise your hands. And there are no abstentions. So there's an equality of votes, therefore as a convener I'll use my casting vote and vote against the amendment. So the amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 81 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. I call Amendment 82 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. I call Amendment 83 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 84 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. I call Amendment 85 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Call Amendment 86 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. I call Amendment 87 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 88 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 9. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. I call Amendment 89 in the name of Jamie Green, already debated with Amendment 9. Jamie Green to move or not move?
Not moved.
Okay. So the question is that Section 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So we now move on to review of recommendations and directions by Parole Board. And I call Amendment 11 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendment 11A. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 11 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Convener, Amendment 11 provides the Parole Board for Scotland with the power to reconsider its decision to release an individual on parole licence in certain circumstances. This directly responds to the points raised by the Chair of the Parole Board, John Watt, when he gave evidence to this committee during Stage 1. And I'm also aware that the committee called on the Scottish Government to find a solution to this issue in your Stage 1 report. Mr Watt expressed his concerns that the Parole Board would not have the ability to review their decision to recommend the release on parole of a prisoner in the circumstance where the board had directed that individual be released on the new temporary release licence until their PQD and that temporary licence is subsequently revoked. In that scenario, the parole board do not have the power to review their original decision and the individual would move to parole licence at their PQD. Amendment 11 directly responds to that scenario and provides the parole board with the power to review their original decision to release on parole licence. And this amendment goes further. It provides the parole board with the power to be able to review its decision in relation to the release of prisoners under Part 1 of the 1993 Act generally. That power is applicable where new information is provided to the board between its decision to recommend release and the point of release, and where the information is considered to have a significant bearing on the individual's suitability for release. Essentially, this amendment gives the parole board the power to place a pause on the individual's release in these circumstances until they consider the new information and decide whether to review their decision to release. As part of that review, the board could uphold the original decision to release, uphold it but amend licence conditions or reverse the decision. It is our view that this amendment provides an important additional safeguard. As this is intended to enable an internal review by the parole board, we have not set out any procedure for these reviews within the amendment. We will consider further whether any change may be needed to the parole board's rules to support this as part of the implementation in due course. Amendment 11A amends Amendment 11 by removing references to recall of long-term prisoners released by the Scottish Ministers under Section 3AB1. That is, release of a long-term prisoner by the Scottish Ministers under the temporary release power provided by Section 7 of this Bill. As Katie Clark's amendments to remove Scottish Ministers' ability to release long-term prisoners on the temporary release licence provided by Section 7 were not moved, I would urge her not to move Amendment 11A, as it would remove an important safeguard and result in an inconsistent approach to review of recommendations by the parole board to release prisoners. And I move Amendment 11 in my name, Convener.
Thank you very much. So Katie Clark to move Amendment 11A and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you. Amendment 11A was put down as a consequential amendment to an amendment which was discussed in the previous group. However, given the Amendment 11 put down by the Cabinet Secretary, I would wish to withdraw Amendment 11A.
Thank you very much. Do any other members wish to come in? No. Cabinet Secretary, do you want to wind up and on Amendment 11?
I have nothing further to add, Convener.
Thank you very much. So, Katie Clark, just to confirm that you intend withdrawing Amendment 11A.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, thank you very much. So the members indicated that they wish to withdraw the amendment. Does the committee have any objection to the amendment being withdrawn? Thank you very much. Thank you. So, Cabinet Secretary, to press or withdraw Amendment 11?
Press.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 11 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. So we now move to power to release early, and I call Amendment 90 in the name of Rona Mackay, grouped with the amendments as shown in the groupings. And I draw members' attention to the procedural information relating to this group as set out in the groupings. I point out that if Amendment 93 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 94 due to a preemption. So Rona Mackay to move Amendment 90 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. The amendments I'm proposing today seek to bring the emergency release provision in this bill in line with changes that were made to the comparable provision within the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Act 2022 at Stage 3. The 2022 Act provides a power to release groups of prisoners who fall within a particular category specified in regulations from prison early. However, of course, this must be in response to the effect that coronavirus is having or is likely to have on a prison or prisons generally. So the power contained in the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Bill is a wider, permanent power
which will be used in response to the effect that an emergency situation is having on a prison or prisons generally. So by its nature, that this is clearly a power that would rarely, if ever, be used, but I believe it's an important safety net to have. Given the amendments that were made to the 2022 Act at Stage 3 were agreed after the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Bill was introduced, it's appropriate that the amendments to the 2022 Act are replicated here. So Amendment 90 seeks to limit the application of the early release power so that prisoners can't be released any earlier than 6 months prior to their scheduled release date. Amendment 92 seeks to exclude people convicted under the Domestic Abuse Protection Scotland Act 2021 from the early release provision. I think that's absolutely crucial. Amendments 91 and 94 are technical amendments and result from Amendments 92 and 90. So all these amendments reflect amendments made to the comparable power contained in the 2022 Act, and I believe that they are necessary to ensure the safety of victims and give them some peace of mind in the unlikely event that they could ever be needed. So I move amendments 90, 92, 91 and 94. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. So call the Cabinet Secretary to speak to Amendment 12 and other amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener. I would like to begin by setting out why I think Section 8 is an important provision. Ensuring the security and good order of our prisons and the health and safety of prisoners and prison staff is absolutely critical, and it is a responsibility I take extremely seriously. The emergency prisoner release power in this bill is intended to support that essential principle by providing a means to release groups of prisoners if the impact that an emergency situation is having or is likely to have puts the security of prisons or the safety or welfare of prisoners or prison staff at risk. This is not a power I would ever hope to use. That is not the reason for including it in this bill. It is in this bill because, as the pandemic showed us, as a government and as a parliament, we have to be able to respond to the unpredictable. We have to ensure that we have the mechanisms in place as far as we can to respond immediately to emergencies where lives may be at risk. And this is one of those mechanisms. Unlike the UK government, who have had such a power since the early 1980s, the Scottish ministers currently have no legal power to instruct early release to protect the security of prisons and the safety and welfare of prisoners and staff, other than specifically in response to COVID. Therefore, without the provisions in Section 8 of this bill, we would require to introduce emergency legislation if we needed to respond to an emergency situation in our prisons in order to protect lives, for example, in the event of a major fire in a prison, of course.
The Cabinet Secretary perhaps give some examples of the types of situations where she would envisage such legislation would be necessary?
So it is clearly in extremis, in an emergency that had an immediate impact and threat to the safety and well-being of staff and prisoners. And I suppose the example of, you know, perhaps a major fire having, you know, a major, you know, impact on a prison that would result in the prison being unsafe.
Thank you.
So picking up the point again in terms of emergency legislation, I think we have to acknowledge, Convener, that even emergency legislation would take time, and it would be time that we could not afford. So including this power in the bill was not a decision that we took lightly, and we have included a number of safeguards which I would highlight do not exist in other jurisdictions. There are statutory exclusions to prevent certain prisoners from being eligible from release under this emergency power. That includes those serving sentences for sexual offences or following conviction under the Domestic Abuse Acts. Furthermore, Amendments 12 and 13, just for clarity, Amendments 12 and 13 in my name, would extend the existing Governor veto. These amendments would enable the prison governor to veto the release of an individual under this emergency release power if they consider that the individual would pose an immediate risk of harm to an identified group of people as well as to an identified individual, as the drafting currently provides. That directly responds to concerns raised by the victim support organisations. Convener, I've heard a number of times that this provision isn't necessary as the powers already exist. This is not correct. It is true that there is a comparable power under the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act 2022. However, that power is only to be used in relation to the impact that the coronavirus is having, and it is temporary, ending in 2025 at the latest. The release power under Section 8 of this bill is designed to be used in an emergency situation which places at significant risk the security and good order of a prison or the health, safety and welfare of prisoners or prison staff. Turning now to the specific amendments in this group, Amendments 90, 91, 92 and 94, in the name of Rona Mackay, bring the early release provision in this bill in line with the comparable provision within the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Act 2022, following changes made at Stage 3 for that Act, and those changes responded to amendments lodged by Jamie Green and Russell Finlay at Stage 2 of that Act. I agree these amendments strengthen the provision, and as such the Scottish Government supports Amendments 90, 91, 92 and 94. I now turn to Amendment 94 in the name of Jamie Green. This amendment would remove the ability for Scottish Ministers to use the made affirmative procedure for the emergency release regulations. This would significantly impair the government's ability to take immediate, necessary and proportionate action to ensure the safety and security of prisons, and for that reason I cannot support it. The Delegated Powers and Legislative Reform Committee quite rightly scrutinised the use of made affirmative in this bill, and the Scottish Government provided them with further detail to inform that scrutiny. I note that the DPLRC's response to this committee on the Delegated Powers Memorandum to this bill, they stated that the majority of the committee is content with the explanation provided by the Scottish Government and accepts the power in principle. The majority of committee is also content that the exercise of the power will be subject to the affirmative procedure, but may be subject to the made affirmative in specified circumstances and by reason of urgency. And I would therefore ask Mr Green not to press Amendment 94. Convener, Amendment 38 in the name of Katie Clark would entirely remove the ability for Scottish Ministers to direct the release of groups of prisoners in response to an emergency situation, a power which I've said is currently available to other jurisdictions within the UK and has been for some time. For the reasons I have set out above, I cannot support Amendment 30, which would remove the ability for Scottish Ministers to release groups of prisoners in response to the impact that coronavirus is having or is likely to have on the security and good order of prisons and the health and safety of prisoners and prison staff. I therefore ask Katie Clark not to move that amendment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, Jamie Green to speak to Amendment 93 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you. So, as has just been discussed, my Amendment 93 does the following. If members look at page 11 of the bill itself, about halfway down, subsection 3D is about parliamentary scrutiny of regulations made under section 3C. The bill goes on to say that regulations under section 3C are subject to the affirmative procedure. It then carries on, unless the following applies, and there are a list of situations where that scrutiny would be removed. My amendment takes a overtly simplistic approach, perhaps, but simply removes the rest of subsection 3D right down until the end and this beginning of section 3E on the following page. And the reason for that is quite simple. It removes Scottish Ministers' ability to release prisoners under Section 3 without some form of parliamentary scrutiny or indeed a vote. Now, the affirmative procedure is often made at committee, which could be an appropriate place. Indeed, this committee has had a number of SSIs over the years. where we have given it full scrutiny and debate and sometimes even pushed it back or brought it to a vote where there is disagreement. So it's a very suitable means of scrutinising decisions like this. I'll come on to section Amendment 38 in a second, because it goes clearly a step much further. But I think my amendment removes what I think is the problematic part of this section. The bill states at the moment that Scottish ministers can release prisoners under the made affirmative procedure if they are of the opinion that by reason of urgency it is necessary to make regulations without their being subject to the affirmative procedure. The Cabinet Secretary in her comments just said that effectively that would impair their ability to make immediate decisions. I would make two points in response. The first is that it's entirely possible for Parliament to make laws when it is necessary in an emergency situation, the sort of emergency situation which remains unknown because the Cabinet Secretary was unable to elicit to the committee what sort of situations really would be suitable to use this power. But as we saw during the coronavirus legislation, we as a Parliament, even when not sitting in person, were able to pass quite broad sweeping laws in very, very short timescales. In fact, the government makes use of emergency protocol to pass law when it suits them. So I cannot understand the rationale that ministers would argue that somehow this will impair their ability to make decisions. I also think there's a fundamental point, and that's that Parliament should be given scrutiny of such decisions. You know, we don't know the numbers or volumes of prisoners that could be released or the reasons given. At the very least, as a courtesy to a committee of the Parliament or the Chamber itself, that a government should be forthcoming with their plans to do that, even at short notice, and give Parliament some say in the matter at the very least, so that it can be properly debated. It's a very, very sweeping power, I'm afraid.
Would you like to take an intervention?
Yeah, in a second, yeah. So, again, Amendment 38 goes a step further. I'm not saying the government necessarily shouldn't have the power. All I'm doing through my amendment is saying that regulations under Section 3 are subject to the affirmative procedure, full stop, and that there are no exceptions to that. Happy to give way.
Yeah, I'm struggling a wee bit with your explanation and as to why you would object to that. And by the very nature of it being an emergency, that there isn't time for scrutiny. It's to be used incredibly quickly, and you know, I think I can't see the reason for objecting to that. An emergency is an emergency, and that's it's just as I said in my notes, it's just a safety net, I think, so that facility is available. I can't see that there's any, you know, hidden meaning behind it. I think it's quite clear cut what it's for.
Well, the problem is it's not clear-cut. I mean, an emergency, the pandemic was an emergency, which is why we passed emergency legislation. And it's interesting the Cabinet Secretary said, you know, it's not a power that the Cabinet Secretary would ever want to use. Mm-hmm. The problem I have, though, is, irrespective of your views, is that previous Cabinet Secretaries have used this power to release prisoners for emergency reasons. And when that power was used, we saw what the consequences are, and that's what I'm coming on to next. So, under the coronavirus legislation, this government, not this Cabinet Secretary, but this government, did use that power to release prisoners. The Scottish government released 348 prisoners in early May 2020 under what was then emergency legislation. Of those 348 prisoners that were released under that emergency legislation, we all understood what an emergency was in that scenario, 142 of them went on to reoffend within 6 months of release, which perhaps is why victims' organisations have such an issue with this. What's worse, though, is that none of the victims involved in any of these cases were informed of the emergency release. And frankly, the use of that power was debatable in that scenario, and the effect that it had on the wider community was debatable. So it's all very well saying it's just a catch-all emergency. You know, we hope we'll never have to use it. The government has used it and may use it again. So all I'm saying is if the government insists on having this power, which I believe is perfectly suitable under the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Act 2022, which I understand is limited to 2025. But if the government wants that power for longer term, it can come back to Parliament and ask for it, or make that permanent if it so wishes. This bill is not the place to put in that power. If the government insists on having that power, then the very least they can do is be forthcoming to Parliament and make sure there's some form of scrutiny. At the moment, there's none. It doesn't exist. And I feel for the protection of future parliaments, which, you know, whether I'm in it or not is irrelevant, such a sweeping power, knowing the effect that it has when you release hundreds or potentially more of prisoners on the community and on victims, it's the very least we can do is ensure that it involves some scrutiny and debate, and ideally a vote, in this case the affirmative procedure, as the government already details. And it's for that reason I'm taking out the rest of Section 3D in my amendment, and also would support Katie Clark's amendment, which I note from the groupings is all supported by another colleague as well.
Okay, thank you very much. So I call Katie Clark to speak to Amendment 38 and other amendments in the group.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and I speak to Amendment 38, which has been put down working with Victim Support Scotland and other victims' organisations who are very concerned about the implications of Section 8 of this bill. I've looked at the wording of Section 8 in detail, and I think it's fair to say that the concerns are related to the wide nature of the drafting of the legislation, the fact that some of the detail will be in regulations, and therefore we don't know what further detail there will be provided by the government, and the lack of certainty in terms of how an emergency would be defined. I'm very sympathetic to the approach outlined by Jamie Green in Amendment 93. This would be a permanent power, and therefore over time it's likely that the legislation potentially could be used in a number of situations and may be used in scenarios that perhaps we currently wouldn't envisage. So it needs to be tightly defined and tightly worded. And I think whilst I'm very sympathetic to what the Cabinet says about the type of very extreme circumstances where it may be necessary to take action of this nature, I think if Parliament was going to pass this legislation, those circumstances would need to be very tightly defined. And of course, I'd be happy to take an intervention.
I appreciate that the circumstances are abstract in some ways, although we understand pandemics and health emergencies and those powers that relate to that. That, you know, I think these are common provisions which exist in other legislations. But the unplanned ones are some of the more extreme situations where in other countries, for example, there has been a prison fire, for example, and the need to release people very quickly. That led to huge amounts of absconding because people literally left the prison gates and never came back. So I think there are scenarios that it would be helpful if the government were a bit clearer as to what sort of potential scenarios might an emergency constitute in order for them to have this, what might be a suitable power to have in that circumstance.
I think that's a helpful contribution, and I asked the Cabinet Secretary to give examples, and the example she gave was perhaps the first example I'd also thought of, and that Jamie Green has also mentioned, of a prison fire. So what, for example, would happen if Berlini or a very, very large prison establishment were to burn down? What would be the emergency response to that situation? And I think I would be far more sympathetic to the government if perhaps there was a defined list, perhaps looking at what's happened internationally and the kinds of real emergencies that do present themselves where it is necessary to take immediate action. I think it's fair to say that probably most situations that would be considered an emergency probably could wait for Parliament to be convened and to consider the issues and to consider whether it was necessary for emergency legislation to be passed. However, there will be other situations and other scenarios, such as a fire, where that may realistically not be possible, where the numbers involved may not be able to be catered for in the rest of the Scottish prison estate, or indeed by asking perhaps the English prison estate to provide assistance. So there may well be scenarios where the law does need addressed and that we do need legislation, but my concern in terms of the drafting of this bill is that it's very widely drafted. It's a permanent power, and it, in my opinion, fails perhaps to define the kind of limited circumstances where it may be necessary for the government to take action and for the Scottish Prison Service to take action on a genuine emergency basis where it's simply not possible for the Scottish Parliament to have an involvement. So, as I say, I'm sympathetic to the approach outlined in Amendment 93 and would, you know, be very interested in whether the Scottish Government is able to look at the drafting of this part of the bill again to see whether it's possible to address some of the concerns that are being raised.
Okay, thank you very much. Do any other members wish to come in? Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much. I think it's a really important grouping and I think a really important discussion because, as Katie Clark has said, I think I'd always be sympathetic to any government having permanent powers if they thought it was justified, because we don't know of all the emergency circumstances that we could ever face. So I'd be totally sympathetic to that. But you wouldn't want to think of an emergency situation where the powers were inadequate, so kind of on that perspective. But like Katie Clark and Jamie Green, what I'm interested in is drilling down a bit then on the regulatory framework and the extent of those powers and the language in the bill, because in one provision it talks about emergency, it's not defined, and in another section, in 7D, it talks about urgency. I'd just like to be clear that they would amount to the same thing in the ordinary meaning. Yeah.
I mean, there is some definition of what would constitute an emergency situation. It's on page 10 of the bill. And, for example, it states, a situation which has resulted in any part of the prison or part of a prison being unusable. I mean, half a Greenock prison is unusable. Does that mean ministers could release prisoners on the basis that there is a water leak or damp? Or, I mean, they're serious. I mean, if, for example, the Health and Safety Executive deems a prison to be unsuitable and is breaching international human rights legislation, would that constitute a reason to the answer probably is no, probably not, and the answer to that by ministers would be probably wouldn't in that scenario, but as drafted it says they could. That's the problem.
I appreciate that intervention from Jamie Green, which speaks to his own amendment in so far as making sure that any regulations can be properly allow the Parliament to properly scrutinise the use of any powers and any adjustments. Two further points, actually three further points. I'm just not sure about the... Am I right in saying there's a provision to give prison governors additional powers for release, and I wondered if we could get that clarification in that. Again, I'd just like to know why that's necessary. Is it for the same rationale? But a further point that Jamie Green makes about the early release of prisoners during COVID does speak to the need, I think, to look... I'm asking the Cabinet Secretary to give thought to this, that in any of these situations where there's early release for emergency reasons, there must be surely conditions attached to that to protect and notify victims. I'm not sure that's contained within the... It also speaks to the fact that, like a lot of other provisions, we haven't really scrutinised, it's occurring to me, large elements of this. And at stage two, a kind of feeling that I'm having to come to draw conclusions on big issues about what powers to give the government and on sentencing in relation to early release. I've actually got concerns about that now. And finally, just on Rona Mackay's Amendment 90. So I am sympathetic to that amendment. I don't know if Rona Mackay wants to intervene. I just wasn't sure about the requirement for 180 days earlier than ministers otherwise be required, because I'm thinking here that, well, if you're serving a year sentence, would the 180 days still apply? Does it apply regardless of to what sentence you're serving? Because it would seem disproportionate if you're serving a sentence of 2 years and you have a 180 day applied, or if you're serving... Perhaps I've misunderstood it, but... I just want to be clear before we come to the vote as to what that would actually mean. And I do support the notion behind it about giving victims certainty about the safety of victims. So, yeah, these are all important principal issues. Yes, I would. Yes, absolutely. Yeah, thank you.
Ms McNeill, I'm going to, by way of intervention, make a few points. I was forgetting that it's not me that's summing up in this group, so I've been sitting here taking notes. Maybe if I could pick up your earlier point. This, in essence, this is about risk to life. Okay. And if we had time to reconvene Parliament, contact committee, you know, get on Teams,
right,
you know, it would not be a decision for this power. It is imperative that we're having this debate right now, because this is exactly the type of discussion and testing we should be having during peacetime, if I can use that phrase, as opposed to scrambling around trying to, you know, pull together emergency actions that may or may not be underpinned by, you know, emergency powers. And what I outlined in terms of the Section 8 of the Bill, in terms of an emergency situation placing at significant risk security and good order of a prison or the health and safety and welfare of prisoners and staff. Essentially, you know, this is about life and limb. And where we could look at Ms McNeill's point about regulations is you can narrow the use in terms of who would be released, and we'll certainly continue to engage with members and victim support organisations on that point. I hope that's helpful.
Thank you very much. That is helpful. Perhaps the government might want to give consideration then to just making sure that it's clear in the statute then, if to be passed, that risk to life is kind of the basis of, because you could understand why ministers would want that power if there's risk to life. I don't think it's contained in those terms. Are you sure?
I'm just struggling with this, and I don't want to get into tripartite debate. But if it's an emergency power that's based on the premise of risk to life, why are there exemptions, such as those convicted of terrorist offences, those subject to an extradition order, those subject to 2010A of the Act for sentences of sex. So are we saying that some prisoners would be released but others wouldn't in a life-threatening situation? So there's it doesn't make sense.
Sorry.
I know you can't intervene on an intervention, sorry. But it just might help. It just doesn't.
So
that comment doesn't make sense.
I'm happy to give way to Cabinet Secretary.
Right, thank you. In terms of the operation of prisons, I appreciate this is difficult in terms of, you know, we're trying to future-proof without knowing what, you know, specific disasters are potentially, you know, coming down the track. But in terms of, you know, needing space within a prison, if a prison didn't have, you know, the capacity to safely, you know, look after all its prisoners, and that was of, you know, significance in that, you know, there was a fire and there was a risk to, you know, the health, safety and life of staff and prisoners, that, you know, there was the absolute necessity to release some prisoners. Well, surely we want to be releasing prisoners that present a lesser risk, and that's part of our work.
So all the terrorists and sex offenders burned to death and everyone else gets out. I mean, it seems such an odd scenario. It doesn't, none of it, the explanation makes sense. So it's an emergency power to be used in a life-threatening situation, which I think we probably agree sensibly.
But we've got to be careful not to, with respect, get to the sublime, to the ridiculous. And I appreciate that it's, you know, difficult in any future-proofing powers to, you know, come up with precise scenarios. But we do have a prison estate that is of more than one prison. So, you know, and these would be the operational decisions made by the prison service at the time of an emergency where, let's just say, you know, a small prison like Greenock was out of use. So you could, of course, you know, move other prisoners elsewhere. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it may be in extremis that decisions have to be made to release some prisoners. And actually, my final point to Ms McNeill is that, but I'm going to give the English comparison here, and it doesn't mean, I'm not for a minute demurring from the fact that we should be debating what I'm asking for in a Scottish context, but just by way of giving some contrast, that the power in England is very broad. It's, you know, what, you know, should the Secretary of State need to make decisions about, you know, the use, the safe use of prison places. So this is already, you know, a power that is, you know, much more, you know, built around the scenario of emergencies. And I think, you know, the undertaking I give to members is, you know, where there have to be, you know, limits in terms of, you know, the regulations about, you know, who in the first instance, you know, could be released. I think that's, you know, eminently sensible.
That is helpful. I would conclude, convener, by saying I think everyone seems to be content that, you know, government should have emergency powers. I think what I would put a plea for is that there's clarity around, and it just kind of, it reads easily as to what this power is about. There is about risk to life, that there are regulations ordinarily, that it's about future-proofing. And lastly, I don't know what your position on Amendment 90 is, but as I said, I'm sympathetic to it. I just don't know if it's proportionate to say in every case that it would be 180 days. That's my only concern. And lastly, it's an important section of the bill to get right. So I would just plead that the government would, if this passes, just give... and lastly, on Jamie Green's point, in these scenarios, I don't see why we can't get into the bill the requirement to notify victims. It seems to be in line with the principle of what we all believe in, and it seems to be missing from the bill.
Much. So, Rona Mackay to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 90.
Thank you, Convener. I think this has been a very useful discussion. And I think we are getting into the finer detail now. I don't think we're really necessarily opposed to the principle, unless I've misunderstood. So, the detail, I'm sure, could be explored at a later stage, but I'm happy to propose Amendment 90. Yes, of course.
Just picking up on some of the points that have been presented to Ms Mackay in earlier debates, in particular in response to a point raised by Pauline McNeill that that further detail, you know, can be set out in the explanatory notes, and that actually in terms of your own amendments, it's with respect to people who have 180 days or less left to serve.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you for that clarification. And I've nothing else to add. I'd like to move Amendment 19.
Thank you very much. So the question is that Amendment 90 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So I call Amendment 12 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 90. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. I call Amendment 13 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 90. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 91 in the name of Rona Mackay, already debated with Amendment 90. Rona Mackay to move or not move?
Move.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 91 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Can I just confirm, Pauline McNeill and Katie Clark, are you in agreement? Thank you. Thank you. I call Amendment 92 in the name of Rona Mackay, already debated with Amendment 90. Rona Mackay to move or not move?
Move.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 92 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 93 in the name of Jamie Green, already debated with Amendment 90. Jamie Green, to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. So I remind members that if Amendment 93 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 94 as it has been preempted. So the question is that Amendment 93 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
OK, we are not agreed. Therefore, we will move to a vote. So those in favour of the amendment, raise your hand. Thank you. Those against the amendment, raise your hand. And there are no abstentions. So there is an equality of votes. Therefore, as a convener, I'll use my casting vote and vote against the amendment. So the amendment is not agreed. So I call Amendment 94 in the name of Rona Mackay, already debated with Amendment 90. Rona Mackay, to move or not move?
Move.
Okay. So the question is that Amendment 94 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So I call Amendment 38 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 90. Katie Clark, to move or not move?
Not moved.
So the question is that Section 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. So that's 25 past 11, so I think we deserve a short break. So I will suspend the meeting for around 10 minutes and ask if members can be back and ready to go at 11:35. Thank you very much. Thank you, members. So we now move on to Section 9, which is release planning. And I call Amendment 95 in the name of Russell Findlay, grouped with the amendments as shown in the groupings. So Russell Findlay to move Amendment 95 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you very much. So this section relates to the planning for a prisoner's release, and I've got four amendments, which are 95, 96, 97 and 98, and they seek to ensure that victims' voices are heard, their rights are respected and their well-being is paramount. It's a thing I'm sure we can all agree on. Now, the Bail and Release from Custody Bill, as drafted, defines a release plan as a plan to prepare a prisoner for release and to facilitate their reintegration into the community. It requires local authorities, health boards, Police Scotland, Skills Development Scotland and integrated joint boards to engage in that process. But we say that victims should also have an input. Amendment 95 would therefore require victim support services to contribute to the process. And I was pleased to receive an email last night in which victims' rights groups expressed their strong support of 95 and other amendments in this section. For the record, they are Victim Support Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid and Assist, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary agrees with them, and I'm keen to hear her response. Now, Amendment 98 is a consequential to 95, and it defines victim support services as currently defined in statute. Amendment 39 from Katie Clark is similar in effect to my Amendment 95. It would require the bodies involved in developing a release plan to consider the role victims' organisations have in these release plans. So while it's not exactly the same as my amendment, it has a similar effect, so I'll be supporting it today if indeed it's pushed. Now, my next amendments are 96 and 97. Release plans in this section of the bill apply to, and I quote, relevant individuals. And what's meant by a relevant individual is a prisoner, whether that be one who is sentenced or on remand. I don't only want victim support services to be consulted in the development of a release plan as per 95. I want there to be a release plan for victims, which is what Amendment 97 would achieve. This would ensure their interests are at the heart of release plan considerations. Now, I know a release plan won't solve every issue, but it will make clear what a victim can expect when an offender is released. Now, Amendment 96 is a consequential to ensure that release plans can be properly applied to victims without needing measures that would only apply to offenders. Turning to Katie Clark's Amendment 40, it states that within 1 year of the section coming into force, ministers would be required to publish guidance and standards applicable to release plans, and that a public consultation should also be carried out. Now, my colleague Jamie Green will speak to his Amendment 99, but that's similar to Katie Clark's. However, he's been more generous to the government, allowing them 3 years rather than one to take those steps. Finally, Amendment 41 from Katie Clark will require the Scottish Government to review release planning for women. Specifically, the review must consider caring responsibilities, health issues and offending history. The reporting requirements would allow for more information to be made public on release plans so we can observe how they work in practice, and I'm therefore happy to support that too. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So Katie Clark to speak to Amendment 39 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And as Russell Findlay has said, my Amendment 39 is similar to the Amendment 95 that has been put down in his name. And my Amendment 39 has been informed, again, by conversations with Victim Support Scotland and other victims' organisations. And they confirm, I think, what we all already know, that victims are not routinely consulted or involved in initiatives intended to address offending. Section 34A2 sets out a list of persons who must comply with any request by Scottish ministers to engage in the development, management and delivery of a release plan for a prisoner, and my Amendment 39 therefore would stipulate that the persons and organisations listed in must have regard to victims and victims' organisations also, and explicitly ensure that they are involved and consulted at all stage in the development and management and delivery of a release plan. My Amendment 40 requires the Scottish Government to report within 1 year on how the release planning process is working and carry out a consultation on the published guidance. I note that the alternative position from Jamie Green is to allow a longer period of time, and I would be flexible in terms of the period of time that it was believed was required to enable this to happen. This amendment, however, would impose a duty on those persons to engage in the development and management of a release plan if requested to do so by the Minister. And so this amendment is an attempt to ensure that the process as set out is as effective and manageable for the organisations involved, and indeed leads to the right outcomes. Amendment 41 is an amendment that I have put down and follows on from the debate that we had at last week's meeting in relation to women in custody. This amendment would require ministers to carry out a review of release planning for women in custody. A key motivation for this amendment is based on what we know regarding the experiences and profile of women in custody, as well as the data and indeed the lack of data that we hold. Scotland, as we know, has one of the largest prison populations in Europe, even though almost 40% of women charged, women being held, are not convicted prisoners. Many of these women we know are very vulnerable. A high proportion are mothers and carers, and indeed many have suffered brain injuries as a result of repeated domestic abuse. Refocusing remand in relation to women is obviously a wider debate, but this amendment would seek to ensure that some of those special circumstances and the profile of women offenders are factored in at release planning stage.
Thank you very much. So I now call Jamie Green to speak to Amendment 99 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I only have one amendment in this group. For the record, I support all the amendments in this group. It is quite notable that there are three sets of amendments from three different members of the committee, which all seek to essentially do what many organisations have been asking us to do, and that's insert a greater role for the third sector and particularly the consideration of victims throughout release planning in the absence of any government amendments to do so. So I'm hoping the government will, you know, at least if not willing to accept overtly any of the amendments in this group, will commit to taking some of them away, and we'll hear more about that shortly. There is something quite interesting about this section for duty to engage in release planning. The bill, as structured, lists the people who have a duty, statutory duty, to engage around release planning: a local authority, health board, Police Scotland, SDS, and an IJB. To be fair to the government, it goes on to say that in complying with that duty, they must have regard to the role in which the third sector can play in the development of release plans and may commission services from those parties. I think it's widely understood that the third sector could include some of the organisations to which we've referred to a lot of this morning. But the problem is they can only be involved if they are commissioned by any of the named parties in Section 34A2, which are the named persons who have the statutory duty. So I think there is scope, certainly in that section, for the government to have a more direct role between the prison service and the third sector, rather than have to go through an intermediate, in this case the local authority, the health board, SDS, or the IGB. So if my interpretation of that is wrong, I'm happy to be corrected, but it feels like there's a missing element there, which is why so many of us have come to this section with ideas. My amendment is similar to Katie Clark's amendment around the reporting requirement. I do support Katie Clark's amendment. I suspect the government will say we're looking at wider reporting requirements that have been added in at various sections of the bill. And I understood earlier we heard a commitment that within part two of the bill there would be greater provision for reporting requirements. I think this would be a sensible addition. I actually was trying to be fair to the government. I think a year was quite a tight time frame to produce that report, and I kindly changed it to three, which is why we have a separate amendment, but very similar in nature. I'd be content with either, and I note that in the correspondence we got from VSS yesterday, they preferred 1 year, but equally would be content with three also. I think they make an interesting point, though, which I did want to put on record, and that's that whilst, as drafted, the persons who must comply in the release development of release plans must have regard to the role in which the third sector bodies are able to play. They propose that Section 34A be amended to explicitly provide that victims of crime and victim support organisations will be involved and consulted in the development, management and delivery of a release plan. And some of the amendments in this group would address that, and therefore they strongly support it and understand why. So I'm hoping we get some positive responses from the government on this set of amendments.
Thank you very much. Would any other member like to come in? No? Okay. Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks, Convener. This group of amendments focus on the critical area of the bill, planning for release from custody. Section 9 of this bill is intended to require earlier engagement in a prisoner's release planning by the universal services they will need on release in order to reduce their risk of reoffending. That is underpinned by a commitment to victim safety. I support the intention of some of the amendments in this group, and I am willing to work with members to see what can be done to bring forward matters at stage three. However, I cannot support the specific amendments as drafted for the following reasons that I'll lay out. Amendments 40 and 99 seek to require the Scottish ministers to publish guidance and standards on release planning in Scotland. I am assuming that is to support implementation of Section 9, but the amendments are not specific on that. They also require Scottish ministers to carry out public consultation on those guidance and standards. And I agree that it will be important that a consistent approach is taken to how Section 9 is implemented across the prison estate and with all the named bodies. I am therefore minded to consider bringing back an amendment at stage three, which would include the requirement for Scottish ministers to develop guidance to support that. I would expect that guidance to also include detail on how best to consider victim safety. I'm not persuaded that separate standards will be needed, however, as there would be a risk of duplication with the proposed standards for through care provided for at section 10 of the bill. I'm also not convinced of the need for public consultation on what would be operational guidance for practitioners. I do agree that we will need to consult relevant stakeholders in the development of the guidance and will consider how to reflect that in stage three amendments. And I would therefore ask members not to press amendments 40 and 99. I now turn to amendment 39 lodged by Katie Clark. This amendment seeks to place a duty on the public bodies named at 34A2 in Section 9 of the Bill to have regard to the role that victims of crime and VSOs are able to play in the development, management and delivery of a prisoner's release plan. That release plan will be a plan to prepare a person for release from custody, whether from remand or sentence, and to facilitate their reintegration and access to universal services. And I understand that the views of the victim and the organisation which support them are crucially important in informing release decisions. Victim safety is a critical consideration in release planning. Victims have the right to receive certain information about the release of a prisoner in their case, and the bill extends that to victim support organisations and can make representations about licence conditions. As this committee is aware, that is provided for by the Victim Notification Scheme, which has just been subject to an independent review. I'm not clear, however, Convener, what role victims and VSOs could appropriately have in relation to the development, management and delivery of a prisoner's release plan that it could place a significant pressure on a victim and be re-traumatising. I would also have concerns about what role a victim or VSO could play in developing a release plan for a prisoner on remand as they have not been convicted of an offence. Of course.
I think the wider point, though, is that what is notably absent is any duty to consult with victims around the release of offender. As you rightly said, the VNS is really the only mechanism, and I know that's subject for review, but we feel like this is an opportunity to put on the face of the bill, if not via these amendments in a future amendment, that victims with their consent, and it's not a blanket, every victim will deal with it. There's also an advantage to the offender as well, because if this is all about release planning, then it's not clearly our intention is to ensure that the ongoing safety of the victim after release. It's an issue we've widely debated, but there may also be advantages to the offender themselves as to know what the parameters around that release and their conditions might be. So even, for example, to ensure they don't breach licence conditions inadvertently, as we have heard is sometimes the case. Indeed, we saw some of that in the hearings that we attended. So that there is significant advantage to offenders as well as victims, and the victim being involved somehow in the process. At the moment, it's just a bit woolly in terms of their involvement with that. So I'm hoping the government could find a mechanism to ensure that there is a duty to consult.
So, convener, I mean, it is important that, you know, when we are considering the involvement and recognition of the needs of victims and their needs for information and security, that we are looking at this in terms of the end-to-end journey. And I suppose my remarks today are very specifically in relation to this bill. And I appreciate they might seem, my remarks will seem quite narrow. So I do want to say that we do need to be looking across the piece. And of course, you know, victims have the right to be making representations to, for example, the parole board. I suppose where, and again at the risk of sounding, you know, quite narrow in my comments, but I am speaking to specific amendments on a specific part of the bill, that in reference to Community Justice Scotland Act 2016, that is a legislation that's focused on offenders, not victims, and any amends on victims just might not fit with that act, in terms of achieving the support and the improved outcomes, you know, whether we're talking about, you know, victims or indeed those being released from prison. So we just have to be really clear about the detail, and I'm more than willing, you know, in the time we've got between now and stage three, to be, you know, delving even deeper into the detail here, because, you know, I'm conscious that this, you know, is a large piece of legislation that is making, you know, amends to several pieces of legislation that is already bit behind us. But I do think it's important, you know, as Mr. Green says, whether for victims or indeed the accused, that we're, you know, getting all the detail right here. I suppose the other point I wanted to make, convener, is that, you know, there are also limits on the information about individual prisoners which can be shared, and therefore it's not clear what role a victim or a VSO could reasonably play in the management and delivery of a prisoner's release plan. And I am concerned about the potential consequences of Ms Clark's amendment and how it would interact with the existing processes under the victim notification scheme. And for those reasons, I cannot support Amendment 39, and I would ask Ms Clark not to press it. In terms of Amendment 95, lodged by Russell Finlay, I think Mr Finlay and I have probably have a completely different view as to what this amendment actually does. But Mr Finlay's amendment is, I believe, seeking to include victim support organisations in the list of public bodies at section 34A2, which have a duty to comply with a request from Scottish ministers to engage in the development, management and delivery of a prisoner's release plan. And as with Amendment 39, I'm not clear what role VSOs could appropriately have in the development, management and the delivery of an individual's prisoner release plan. And in this light, I cannot support Amendment 95, and I would ask Mr Finlay not to press it. Amendment 98's proposed definition for victim support services intended to bring in organisations providing support services does not work, as there is not a corresponding definition in the new Section 16ZA of the Criminal Justice Scotland Act 2003, which Mr Finlay's amendment cross-refers to. Further, on the basis that this amendment is dependent on Amendment 95, which I have also urged Mr. Finlay not to press, I do not think it would be necessary to pass this amendment, and I would therefore ask Mr. Finlay not to press it. The specific intention of Amendments 96 and 97 is not entirely clear from the text alone. It would appear that, taken together, the intention of Amendment 97 is to include victims within the definition of a relevant individual for whom release planning can take place, alongside individuals on remand or serving custodial sentences. As I've discussed previously, the intention of Section 9 is to require earlier engagement in a prisoner's release planning by the universal services they will need on release in order to reduce the risk of reoffending. Victim safety will be a key part of that planning. Prisoner release planning is not the same as victim safety planning, and these amendments, I fear, risk conflating the two. And I therefore cannot support Amendments 96 and 97, and I ask Mr. Finlay not to press them. Lastly, Convener, Amendment 41, lodged by Katie Clark, would require Scottish ministers to carry out a review of release planning in regards to women within 2 years of the section coming into force, and to publish a report on its finding. The Scottish Government and Scottish Prison Service recognise the specific needs of women in custody. That is why we are taking a different approach to the women's estate and why the strategy for women in custody is so important. As I said in response to Russell Finlay's Amendment 71 in an earlier group, I am minded to come forward with a Stage 3 amendment which will encompass all of the various asks for reviews into the different sections of Part 2 to provide a more coherent picture, and that would include a focus on release planning for women. And in light of this, I would ask Ms Clark not to press Amendment 41.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So, Russell Finlay, to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 95.
Thank you very much. I note the Cabinet Secretary acknowledges that this, the views of victim support organisations and indeed victims is crucial and critical, but I might add, except when they're not. The issue appears to be that the Cabinet Secretary can't see what role victim support organisations would play. That phrase was stated on more than one occasion. However, the victim support organisations do see these amendments as being valid and do see... Yes.
Could I just ask Mr Finlay if he could outline what role victim support organisations should play in the delivery of a prisoner's plan?
Well, they would be representative of victims. They would be able to... Okay. Well, I was going to come on to the point that you made around the statutory requirement for them to be involved. I want to make the more general, broader point, which is they see a role in both the planning for release and the general consultation for around that. Where was I?
Would the member take an intervention?
Yes.
Taking on board what the Cabinet Secretary is questioning in terms of delivery, perhaps an example of how maybe victims' organisations might be involved in the delivery of such services would be perhaps around about housing allocation and whether it's appropriate for someone that's been convicted of a violent offence to be, say, relocated in the same part of a town as the complainer. Would that be the kind of example, maybe, that might be appropriate for victims' organisations to be involved with?
Potentially, yes, indeed. Yes.
I wonder if Mr Finlay, and thank you for giving me, would agree that there is a very clear distinction between planning for someone's release and absolutely there needs to be victim support input into the plans that are made. But that is very distinct from the management of offenders and the delivery of services to manage offenders. And I just think it's important
sure.
that, you know, no one wants to be silencing victims that they have to be involved in these end-to-end justice journeys. But we need to be clear that we are not expecting victims or victim support organisations to be involved in the management of offenders or the delivery of those management plans, because that clearly arrests with other agencies.
Yeah, no, I do understand that distinction, and that's been explained in your response, which is why I think I'm minded at this stage not to move it, because you've already, the Cabinet Secretary has already expressed a willingness to work with members to find a way to... Yes.
I mean, the rationale for the benefit of the Cabinet Secretary is that victim support organisations themselves wrote to us saying they would like to be involved in the delivery, not just the planning, and it's in black and white. So, I mean, if we want to know what they think their role is, perhaps we should ask them, perhaps the government should ask them, then they wouldn't have to write to us the night before stage two. And I would strongly advise that either the committee or the government speaks to these three organisations ahead of stage three. And if they feel that there's not a role in delivery, but there is a role in the planning, then we can find a way around that. There, of course, are other ways of amending the bill as it is. I mean, Section 34A, in terms of the duty to engage in release planning, is the duty to engage, not the duty to deliver. So, I mean, that whole paragraph where it talks about the statutory persons in the development, management and delivery of release plan, well, that could easily be split out into two sections. It could be a group of people who are statutory named persons in the development of, and another group who are involved in the delivery of, as you rightly pointed out, there is a difference. So, you know, I think there will be solutions to this that do not place undue statutory duties on organisations who don't want them and who don't need them, but equally reflect the views of these organisations. So I'm sure that my colleague and I will work on such amendments with the government if they're willing to.
Yeah, no, absolutely, I agree with what Jamie Green said. I think there's a couple of other small points to make. Victim notification scheme was referred to. We know that it's not working. We know that the review has been pretty harsh in its assessment, but I don't think that is a substitute, certainly not in the way it's not working just now, as a properly robust mechanism in the bill to ensure victims' voices are properly heard. And I look forward to bringing that back in a better, more competent shape. I'm also slightly mindful of a more general approach that I'm hearing more and more about, whereby there's almost a justification not to inform victims because to do so can cause them further distress. But I think that's at odds with reality, and it's not a reason in itself to not keep people informed, and it's not something I've heard victim support organisations talking about. But to recap, look forward to having a rethink and hopefully working together to find a way to bring this back in a better shape. So thank you.
Thank you very much. So just to confirm if you're pressing or withdrawing Amendment 95.
Withdraw.
Okay. So the members indicated that they wish to withdraw the amendment. Does the committee have any objection to the amendment being withdrawn? No. Okay. Thank you very much. So I call Amendment 39 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 95. Katie Clark, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 96 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 95. Russell Finlay, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 97 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 95. Russell Finlay, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 98 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 95. Russell Finlay, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 40 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 95. Katie Clark, to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. I call Amendment 99 in the name of Jamie Green, already debated with Amendment 95. Jamie Green, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. So the question is that Section 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 41 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 95. Katie Clark, to move or not move?
No.
Thank you. Thank you. So we now move to post-custody outreach, and I call Amendment 100 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, grouped with Amendment 101. Douglas Lumsden to move Amendment 100 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And in moving my amendment, I'd just like to set some context around it. So I've been an MSP for just over 2 years now, and one of the first people to contact me after being elected was a brave and determined woman called Sandra Geddes. Sandra told me about the story of her brother, Alan Geddes. Alan stayed less than a mile away from me, from my house, in an area called Rutherston in Aberdeen. In December 2019, Alan was murdered by a man called Stuart Quinn. Dad of one, Alan, was stabbed 40 times by Quinn. Good Samaritan Alan Geddes was murdered after offering a recently released Quinn a place to stay in his home. Quinn had been released from prison just hours before without any proper support package and no accommodation in place. This is because his sentence was backdated after being held on remand, so he was released from custody with little preparation. The Mental Welfare Commission conducted an investigation into the circumstances leading up to this killing, particularly with a focus on the care and treatment received by the killer prior to his sudden release from jail in 2019. This bill provides an opportunity for the Scottish Government to act on the recommendations outlined in this report, and that is why I'm proposing my amendments today. Amendment 100 would establish a post-custody outreach service for offenders who have been released from jail, as recommended by the Mental Welfare Commission. In setting up this service, Scottish ministers would be required to consult with Community Justice Scotland, each local authority and each health board. This would enable a holistic approach to be taken across the whole system, with both the justice and health perspectives considered before establishing this service. My amendment goes on to commit to providing a point of contact for every person released from custody who has at some point spent some time detained in hospital. This was the case with Alan's murderer. Clearly, a person who has been detained in hospital at some point requires additional support compared to other offenders, given the mental health problems that that person has encountered. And so it's vital that there is someone in place to proactively outreach to them. Indeed, my amendment would require that offenders who fall into this category are contacted by their point of contact within the post-custody outreach immediately upon their release from prison, so they have someone to go to straight away. Hopefully, this will ensure there is always somebody a recently released prisoner can reach out to if they are experiencing trouble. My amendment intends for this service to last for a year after the prisoner has been released. I've also allowed Scottish ministers the opportunity through regulations to set out what else should be provided by this post-custody outreach service. Through consultation with other stakeholders, I hope a comprehensive service can be developed which prevents a situation like Alan Geddes' murder from ever happening again. Amendment 101 is consequential amendment to 100, which introduces the post-custody outreach service. Alan's sister, Sandra, says she wakes up every morning thinking about what her brother went through and would never want any other family to experience that. And we can try and make sure it never does. I'm happy to work with the Scottish Government if they think the amendment needs further work, but I hope they are supportive of the principle. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Would any other members like to come in? Fulton Gregor.
Yeah, thanks, and welcome Douglas Lumsden to the committee. And thank him for the powerful way that he put forward his constituents' case. It was very powerful, as I say, indeed. I'm actually quite sympathetic to where Mr Lumsden is wanting to go with this in a very general sense, but I wouldn't be inclined to vote for it at this stage because there would be quite a number of questions that I would have. And I think that the committee as a whole would actually have, probably the government too, you know, just about would only apply if the person has been detained under the mental health legislation. How long ago would that detention have to have taken place? What supports would the amendment actually put in place for people? So I think it's probably a bit like another amendment I spoke about earlier. I see the principle of it and you've came at it very passionately, and I don't think anybody can take that away or deny you that, Mr. Lindsay, nor would I seek to. But I would have quite a lot of questions about the actual effect of the amendment at this point. They're just some of them. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
No, it's actually, I listened to the Cabinet Secretary last week and she said, if not this, then what? And if not now, then when? And that's probably the same question I've got now. This is, for me, I think is an ideal opportunity to put this in place. You know, we have the recommendations from the Mental Welfare Commission. And if we're not putting anything in place now, when is that actually going to happen? This could be another report that I feel could just gather dust if we don't, you know, put something in place now.
Thank you for that intervention. I acknowledge the report and the recommendations and that. And my point would be, though, it would be a big piece of work. It would be a big change, and it's whether this is the right place. So I'm interested to hear how the Cabinet Secretary is going to respond. But I do think there is quite a lot of questions just now. And just because we think something should be done in principle, and there's obviously a really emotive background to the situation and the story that you've outlined, it would need to be done right, because we wouldn't want to create a situation where it could actually make things worse. And if things like, you know, where would the person have to have been detained, under what legislation, under what sort of conditions, mental health conditions, if all that's not ironed out properly, it could be worse for people in the long run, and that would be my concern. And I just want to put that on record, those concerns, although I do again, I want to go back to say that the principle of Mr. Lumsden's
very much.
Plea to committee is noted.
Thank you. Any other members? If not, I'll bring the Cabinet Secretary in.
Firstly, Convener, I want to put on record my sympathy to the Geddes family and say that I support the underlying intention of this amendment, which appears to be to ensure that people leaving custody are able to access support for mental health problems should they need it. And I very much recognise that this amendment stems from a recent Mental Welfare Commission report into the case that Mr. Lumsden has raised, and he has, you know, consistently and compassionately raised for some considerable time now. The Scottish Government are carefully considering this report and all of the recommendations within it, and they will, you know, respond formally in the coming weeks. The Government has to provide a response in full. That will be led by health ministers, but I can assure Mr. Lumsden that I have a particular interest in this particular report. And while I do not want to preempt the content of the government's response, so I won't necessarily go into particular details on the various recommendations, but the Mental Welfare Commission report does highlight the particular difficulties that can arise when an individual has been released directly from remand by the court, especially in circumstances where that outcome was not anticipated. And I know that this is an issue which the committee has considered during your scrutiny of the bill, and it is certainly an issue that I recognise. We did consult on the provision of support for people released direct from court when developing the bill, but it was not clear, however, that a legislative solution was the best one. That is not to say that nothing can be done, and I intend to work with stakeholders to identify policy and operational solutions before stage three, and I'm doing so at the request of the convener in her capacity as an individual MSP. As we've discussed, this bill aims to foster a more effective multi-agency approach to release planning. It will strengthen the role and responsibility for a range of public services to engage in pre-release planning, and require Scottish ministers to establish statutory standards for through care for the first time. And that covers both remand and sentenced prisoners. This amendment, however, goes beyond the prison release process for understandable reasons, and it would have a significant and lasting impact on mental health approaches, as well as it also has resource implications too. While it would not be appropriate to try and implement, in my view, such a change in the context of this legislation when there has not been prior consideration and discussion, it is nonetheless a significant matter that requires further consideration, but we have to do so in all appropriate forums. And I do appreciate the members' very close interest in this issue, and perhaps it would be helpful to discuss the details of the Mental Welfare Commission report separately with him. As I've said that, of course.
I'm just trying to think that if it wasn't part of this bill and wasn't, you know, the amendments weren't accepted, what would be the government approach going forward? Would there be additional legislation, or would it just be guidance? What would your thinking be on that?
So I think there's a legitimate question whether it would actually need legislation. But as I said, I'm happy to discuss that further with Mr. Lumsden. I do also think it would be useful that if he was willing to have a discussion with me in the context of this bill, that we also include as part of that discussion health ministers who will have a responsibility to respond in the not-too-distant future to all of the recommendations made by the Mental Welfare Commission. I do think there is an absolute need to be discussing how we better support people direct from court. My, you know, fundamental question is, you know, whether all of that solution will lie in this legislation or not. Can I move on a wee bit, if that's okay? However, coming back to the matters before the committee today, I do have some concerns about the unintended consequences of this amendment, which I would like to explain. Amendment 100 places a duty on the Scottish ministers to establish a post-custody outreach service for individuals released from custody, either for remand or sentence, people who have previously been detained in hospital. And I'm just going to pick out, I'm going to detail some of my concerns in and around the amendment. That does not mean there is not merits to an outreach service. So in terms of what has been drafted, I am assuming that that means detained under mental health legislation, although the amendment does not specify that. The amendment provides that this detention could have taken place at any time. It could have been years or even decades before the individual's release from prison, and that detention could have been for a reason completely separate from the reason that a person is in prison, for example, for suicidal ideation or concerns about self-harm. The amendment requires that service would provide a point of contact for these individuals on release and then regular contact for a year following liberation. And the amendment does not specify what that contact should entail and whether this is a mental health support service, wider social support, or whether it would be for supervision. And that makes it very hard to determine the purpose of the service and its potential impact. Hence, you know, that I think this is a much broader issue than legislation, although I understand why Mr. Lumsden is pursuing the course of action that he is. It's also not clear whether the contact would be on a compulsory or a voluntary basis, and this is quite an important point of detail. As I'm sure Mr. Lumsden will be aware, compulsory treatment is only allowed in very strict circumstances, and it's not clear how the service proposed by this amendment would fit into that wider mental health landscape. And I do very much recognise the importance of holistic, well-planned support for people leaving prison. That is one of the underlying purposes of this bill, and it is why the government already funds, you know, local authorities and third sector organisations to deliver through care. Therefore, in addition to my specific concerns about the scope of this amendment, I'm also not clear how such a service could fit into the existing landscape of support for prison leavers and mental health services, and particularly where it would overlap with existing services. And it is for that reason that I cannot support Amendment 100 and the Associated Technical Amendment 101, and I would ask Mr Lumsden not to move them. But while I am resisting these amendments, I am not for one moment rejecting the issues that Mr Lumsden has raised, which is why I would be further happy to meet with him, along with other ministers, as well as the engagement with stakeholders that I committed to in my interactions with the convener, to see how we can move this situation forward in ways that that will have direct impact on practice and on the front line.
Thank you very much, Convener and Cabinet Secretary. I know the comments that you've made. So now, Douglas Lumsden, I invite you to wind up if you've got further comments you'd wish to make, and press or withdraw Amendment 100.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and I'll just be quite brief on this. You know, I welcome the opportunity to engage with the Cabinet Secretary, and I would hope that would be extended to Sandra Geddes as well, Alan's sister. I know she would welcome that, because she's always said that her brother was failed, but she also accepts that the attacker, Stuart Quinn, was failed. You know, he was let out one night, nowhere to go, just got chatting with somebody else randomly at a bar, who tried to get him some accommodation that night, couldn't get anything, and then offered him a place to stay for that night, with the tragic consequences that came from that. So, you know, I welcome the engagement. In terms of press, I still intend to press my amendment. Yes, of course.
Just wanted to come in quickly. The point was, Alan Geddes died because the state failed. They failed this particular prisoner. The Mental Welfare Commission report is absolutely damning, and I think Sandra Geddes deserves great credit for having lost her brother in such horrific circumstances, campaigned so effectively and working alongside you to get to this point. And I think it's very welcome that the Scottish Government are showing a willingness to find some form of way forward. So, thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, it is all about Sandra, and as I said in my initial comments, you know, a brave and determined woman. That's why I'm here today. And you know, she always, as I said, points out that it was Stuart Coombe was also failed by the state. So, you know, I want to press on with this. Welcome the engagement. If we can change it for coming back at a later stage, then you know I'd be happy. I'd like to press on with it today. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much, Mr. Lumsden. So the question is that Amendment 100 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Can I just check? Are we all agreed? No. Okay, thank you. We're not agreed. Therefore, we'll move to a vote. So all those in favour of the amendment, raise your hands. Thank you. All those against, raise your hands. Thank you. There are no abstentions, so there's an equality of votes. Therefore, as a convener, I'll use my casting vote and vote against the amendments. The amendment is therefore not agreed. So I call Amendment 101 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, already debated with Amendment 100. Douglas Lumsden, to move or not move?
Not move.
Not move, thank you. Thank you very much. So now we move on to through care, and I call Amendment 42 in the name of Katie Clark, grouped with the amendments as shown in the groupings. So Katie Clark to move Amendment 42 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and I speak to Amendment 42, which is a probing amendment. Section 34B sets out that Scottish ministers must publish standards applicable to through care in Scotland, and that in preparing, reviewing and revising the standards, various bodies should be consulted. This amendment stipulates that this consultation should be public. Establishing new statutory minimum standards for through care support is a key change that affects individuals' successful integration into the community and offers assistance around accommodation, healthcare, education, employability and other services, and so input from wider communities can only be useful. And I look forward to hearing from the Cabinet Secretary what the Government's thinking is in relation to this proposal. Amendment 43 is another amendment that has been informed by discussions with Victim Support Scotland. The argument is that support that is provided must be safely and appropriately designed and also address the needs of victims, but there is currently no specific reference to engagement with victims of crime or their support organisations in this legislation. So this amendment is similar to many of the other amendments that we've discussed in previous grouping, and this amendment would ensure that the specific input of victims' organisations is required. Amendment 3 relates to resource issues, which we have debated on a number of occasions previously. In previous groupings, we have debated reporting amendments that recognise that without greater funding and resource, the fear is that many of the organisations who will have obligations put on them by this piece of legislation will simply not be able to deliver them adequately due to lack of resource. So this amendment is designed to highlight the overburdening of responsibilities on organisations without adequate funding and resource, and to ensure greater parliamentary scrutiny going forward, this amendment would ensure that those bodies who are required to comply with requirements round through care standard supports have the capacity to do so, and that this Parliament is actively scrutinising whether resources are put in place to ensure that the legislation is meaningful. Amendment 44 relates to access to training, education and work opportunities on remand. There is currently no statutory basis to enable this to happen, although my understanding is that some prison establishments do attempt to provide such opportunities to remand prisoners, even though there's no legal basis to do that. As we have discussed previously on many occasions, we have high numbers of untried prisoners in the prison system, often for extended periods of time. And as we've discussed previously, the length of period that individuals are being held on remand has grown considerably for a number of reasons, including the extension of time limits and legislation passed by this Parliament, but also exacerbated by the pandemic. There will be a range of different types of accused people that are being held on remand, and many will be there for non-violent offences, but significant numbers will be there for charges of a significant nature. This amendment would enable untried prisoners to have greater access to services which are currently available to convicted prisoners. It is an amendment that's tied with the through care section, as it was ensured that such obligations are guaranteed and could be available immediately as soon as a period in custody starts. Clearly, there are operational and other considerations that would be needed to be taken into account. But for example, some types of training and different type of opportunities might be more appropriate for someone that's only going to be there perhaps for less than a week, whilst if the prison knows that an individual that is going to be with them for an extended period of time, obviously a range of other opportunities and training might be more appropriate to have available. And this amendment is seeking to open up this debate, and if there was specific problems round about the wording, then obviously that would be something I'd be very happy to discuss with the Scottish Government. But the principle is that some of the services and access to education, training and work opportunities that are available to convicted prisoners should be available to remand prisoners, and that that would significantly improve the quality of the time that those individuals spend in custody. And we should remember that those people have not been convicted of anything, but also may be of significant benefit to the Scottish Prison Service itself. As I say, I understand that this does happen on occasions already, although I'm not convinced there's a statutory basis to that.
Thank you very much. So, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to Amendment 14 and other amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener. Section 10 of this bill requires Scottish Ministers to establish through care standards for both remand and sentenced prisoners. I welcome this committee's support for these provisions. I recognise that in order for these standards to be as effective as possible, they need to be informed by a range of views. That's why Section 10 includes a list of bodies Scottish Ministers must consult when preparing, reviewing and revising the standards. The amendments I'm bringing forward today seek to extend that list further. Amendment 14 adds the Risk Management Authority in recognition of the valuable insight it will have in ensuring the standards sufficiently manage risk and are informed by best practice. Amendment 15 adds the Care Inspectorate, reflecting its role in the scrutiny and assurance of community justice and justice social work. Amendment 17 requires consultation with groups which focus on providing support to children, young people and families impacted by imprisonment, allowing the voice of children and families to shape the standards and their specific needs to be considered. Amendment 16 is a technical amendment to allow this list to be expanded. Amendments 18 to 20 expand the list of statutory consultees to include victim support organisations, allowing the standards to be reflective of victims' needs and ensuring they continue to centre on victim safety. I have brought forward these amendments directly in response to calls made to this committee and by victim support organisations. Amendments 18 and 19 define victim support organisations in line with Section 11 of this bill, and Amendment 20 allows Scottish Ministers to amend part of this definition subject to the affirmative procedure, again in line with Section 11, and I ask that committee supports these government amendments. Turning now to Katie Clark's amendments, Amendment 43 would require Scottish Ministers to consult with victims of crime and victim support organisations in the preparation, review and revision of the standards. I agree that consultation with the VSOs on these standards is critical, and that's why I've lodged amendments 18 to 20 today. However, I can't support Katie Clark's amendment 43 just for a couple of reasons. First of all, the definition of victim support organisations provided in this amendment is not consistent with the definition used elsewhere in the bill. The government's definition of victim support services goes further and encompasses organisations which provide services intended to benefit the health and well-being of victims and those which provide support for safety planning and making representations regarding prisoner release. Also, my amendments provide the ability for ministers to amend the definition of victim support services. Amendment 43 doesn't do that. Secondly, Amendment 43 would require the Scottish Ministers to consult directly with victims on the development of these standards. And I agree that it will be critical that the standards are informed by the experiences of victims of crime. However, it is also important that victims are consulted in a way which is trauma-informed and supported. And my view is that this is best done via victim support organisations. And it's for these reasons I cannot support Amendment 43. I would, however, argue that my amendments 18 to 20 will achieve the same aim, and I would ask Katie Clark not to press Amendment 43. Turning to Amendment 42, it appears this amendment is intended to require Scottish Ministers to carry out public consultation in relation to the through care standards. I support the principle of this amendment. However, as drafted, I do not believe it will deliver the intended purpose. Section 34B4 is already a duty to carry out a public consultation when preparing, reviewing and revising the standards. The through care standards will undergo extensive consultation and during this period, Scottish ministers must consult a wide range of people, bodies and organisations. Additionally, Scottish ministers may consult anyone else they consider appropriate. Because of this, Ms Clark's amendment would have little or no effect on the current requirement in the bill to consult when the standards are prepared, reviewed and revised under Section 34B4. However, I recognise there is a wider public interest in this area, and the government should be open to hearing the views of communities impacted by through care. Therefore, I will commit to bringing forward an amendment at Stage 3 which would require Scottish ministers to undertake a formal public consultation on the draft standards following the consultation and development with the listed partners. I ask Ms Clark not to move Amendment 42 today. Turning to Amendment 44, this amendment would require ministers to take steps to ensure individuals who are remanded in custody can receive through care support and access to activities and opportunities from the start of their period in custody. I do agree that it is important that remand prisoners have access to support on release. That is why both the pre-release planning duty and the through care standards provided in this bill also cover remand prisoners. I am not clear, however, what practical effect this amendment would have. Remand prisoners can already access through care support from their local authority on a voluntary basis under the Criminal Justice Scotland Act 2003. The third sector through care services already offer support to women and young people released from remand. I recognise that this does not include men released from remand, and that is something that we are considering. Obviously has resource implications, but it doesn't require legislation, though. If the amendment is intended to go further in mandating that every remand prisoner engage in through care support, there would be further legal issue with this. It is fundamental that engagement with through care support is voluntary unless someone has been sentenced, and that sentence includes supervision requirements. They cannot be forced to engage with any form of follow-up on support after they are released from custody. The prison rules do not exclude remand prisoners from work or purposeful activity, and the prison service will, where possible, offer access to work and educational opportunities for those on remand. Therefore, I would argue that Amendment 44 does not add to current practice, and I would ask Ms Clark not to move it. Yes.
Intervention on that point. And what is the Cabinet Secretary's view in terms of the current access to education, training and cultural experiences for those on remand compared with those who've been convicted? What's her understanding of how the Scottish prison system operates?
So my understanding is that there's not a bar on remand prisoners from participating in, you know, purposeful, helpful activity. Obviously, as you outlined in your own remarks, that depending on the length of time, it's anticipated that someone is within or going to be within a custodial sentence, that in terms of longer term interventions, or that priority may be given to longer term prisoners or sentenced prisoners. Finally, convener, in turning to Amendment 3, also lodged by Ms Clark, this would place a duty on Scottish ministers to publish a report on the impact of the through care standards on partners, including in relation to resource implications and whether adequate resources are available to support implementation. I am clear that resourcing is a critical consideration in the delivery of successful through care. That's why we currently fund local authorities and third sector organisations. There is a risk that this amendment, as drafted, will place further administrative burdens on partners to provide evidence of whether the resources are adequate, and that it is likely, understandably, to look very different across all local areas. Furthermore, it should be noted that this amendment would require Scottish ministers to publish this report within 1 year of the section being commenced. I would draw members' attention to the fact that the bill, as drafted, requires the standards to be developed within 1 year of commencement. So we could end up with a scenario where partners were being required to provide information on the impact of standards just published. And as I said in my response to Russell Finlay's Amendment 71 in an earlier group, I am minded to come forward at Stage 3 with amendments that will encompass all the various asks for reviews into different sections of Part 2 to provide a more coherent picture, and that could include a review of the impact of through care standards. And it's for this reason that I ask members, ask the member, pardon me, not to move Amendment 3.
Much, Cabinet Secretary. So, Kitty Clark to... Oh, I beg your pardon, before I jump on, can I bring in any other members that may wish to speak? No? OK, thank you very much. So, Kitty Clark to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 42.
Thank you, Convener, and it wouldn't be my intention to push any of these amendments to the vote at this stage. However, I do think that they raise important issues, both in relation to the involvement of victims that we've already discussed previously, and indeed the involvement of victims' organisations, but also in relation to the resource challenges that the justice system currently faces, and which are unlikely to be impacted by anything that is within the legislation being proposed by the Scottish Government. In relation to Amendment 44, the evidence that the committee has received previously is, as I understand it, that the types of activities that are available to those on remand is greatly restricted compared with convicted prisoners. It may be that the practice of the Scottish Prison Service is changing over time, and it would be useful to get more information about that before the next stage of the bill. As I say, I don't plan to press any of these amendments at this stage.
OK, thank you very much. So just to confirm that you wish to withdraw Amendment 42.
Yes.
Thank you. So the members indicated that they wish to withdraw the amendment. Does the committee have any objection to the amendment being withdrawn? No? OK, thank you. So I call Amendments 14, 15, 16, 17 and 18, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendments 14 to 18 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 14 to 18?
No.
OK, thank you. So the question is that Amendments 14 to 18 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
OK. So I call Amendment 43 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 42. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Call Amendment 19 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 42. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Okay. So the question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 20 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 42. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 3 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 42. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. The question, beg your pardon, so I call Amendment 44 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 42. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. So the question is that Section 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So just before we move on to the next group, I note that we've only got two more groups left. I absolutely do not want to curtail debate, but as we move into the next group, I wonder if I can just gently ask members to be succinct where they can, and we should be able to finish stage two today. So on that note, we move on to provision of information to victim support organisations. And I call Amendment 45 in the name of Katie Clark, grouped with the amendments as shown in the groupings. And I draw members' attention to the procedural information relating to this group as set out in the groupings. And I would point out that if Amendment 45 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendments 102 and 21 due to a preemption. If Amendment 47 is agreed I cannot call amendments 103 and 24, again due to a preemption. If amendment 48 is agreed, I cannot call amendments 104 or 105, again due to a preemption. So Katie Clark to move amendment 45 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 45 is a technical amendment. It was agreed with Victim Support Scotland. Section 11 suggests that a victim support organisation acting as a supporter can, on their own volition and without the victim's specific consent, ask for information under this section. This amendment would require that specific consent was required. Victims' organisations do not believe that it is appropriate that the legislation as drafted should proceed, as they believe it would undermine victims' agency, override victims' autonomy and consent, and undermine victims' trust in professionals if they were aware that information could be provided without specific consent, and therefore would make them less willing to engage in future. This amendment ensures the victim support organisation can only obtain the relevant information if it gives express information to do so by the victim or indeed in certain circumstances on the victim's behalf or on behalf of the victim or the organisation. Amendment 46, which is a consequential amendment, again, was agreed with Victim Support Scotland. This refers to the section allowing victim support organisations to obtain information around the victim's right to representations where a prisoner is being considered for release and licence. The view is that wording of the section as drafted is problematic and raises similar issues as raised in relation to Amendment 45. So the suggestion is that one way of dealing with that would be to remove it from the bill. Amendment 48, again, was agreed and discussed with Victim Support Scotland. It stipulates that there must be victims' consent at each stage. For example, victims' consent, for example, at information sharing provisions. It replicates the 2014 Act regarding information sharing provisions, and the approach being outlined is the approach that's being asked for by organisations who've worked with victims and represent victims. And for that reason, I'm bringing it to the committee to hear the Cabinet Secretary's thinking and the Scottish Government's response to the representations that have been made to members of this committee, but I suspect have also been made to the Scottish Government.
Thank you very much. So I now call Russell Finlay to speak to Amendment 102 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much. Now, these amendments relate to the sharing of information about victims with third-party organisations. If I understand Katie Clark's amendments 45, 47 and 48, this would remove the ability of a supporter of a victim to be given this information in certain circumstances. And I agree with Katie Clark, but I believe there's perhaps a different way of achieving this, and that's with my amendments 102, 103 and 104. These would ensure information is still available to those who want it, but crucially where there is the consent and support of victims. I think it leaves what could be a potentially useful channel of communication open. I note also that the victim support organisations have made representation to committee members and are quite critical of some of the Cabinet Secretary's amendments in this section. They oppose six of these and seek for one of them to be withdrawn, and if one was to proceed, for that to be subject to substantial revision. Returning to my own amendments, I think this is a better solution than the one being proposed by Katie Clark, but happy to hear more, because it may well be there's something that's not obvious to me. So thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary to speak to Amendment 21 and other amendments in the group.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Before addressing the amendments lodged by Katie Clark and Russell Finlay, I will speak to the amendments in my name. Section 11 allows victims to nominate a victim support organisation to receive information regarding the release of a prisoner in their case. This is intended to enable a more trauma-informed approach to this information sharing and allows victims to be better supported in release planning. During stage one, concerns were raised that the bill, as currently drafted, would have the unintended consequence of allowing a victim support organisation to request information on behalf of a victim where the victim had not given consent. As such, we have lodged amendments 21, 24 and 105, which address this concern. VSOs will be required to seek and secure the consent of victim before requesting any information about a prisoner on behalf of a victim they are supporting. Amendments 21 and 24 require consent in relation to prisoners sentenced to 18 months or more. Amendment 105 is an equivalent amendment in relation to victims of prisoners serving sentences of less than 18 months. Turning to amendments 22, 23, 25, 26 and 27, this group of amendments extend the provision in section 11 to victims where the perpetrator is a patient in the forensic mental health system. Amendment 23 enables victims where the perpetrator is subject to a compulsion order and a restriction order to nominate a VSO to receive the same information the victim is entitled to, and gives a VSO the right to ask for this information. Scottish ministers will provide the information if they are satisfied that the victim has consented to the VSO making the request. Amendment 25 gives the VSO the right to be told about certain decisions if nominated by the victim. Similar to Amendment 23, VSOs can also request this information where they have consent to do so. Amendments 22, 26 and 27 are technical amendments to the Criminal Justice Scotland Act 2003 in consequence of Amendments 23 and 25. Now, turning to Amendments 45 to 48 lodged by Katie Clark, like Government...
Sorry, thank you. I just wonder what the Cabinet Secretary would say in response to the concerns raised by the victim support organisations to her amendments.
So, Mr Finlay, I hope will be reassured that my officials, you know, have and will continue to, as I will, engage extensively with victim support organisations. We are currently at stage two. I'm laying out why I think the amendments that I have lodged are necessary, and I'm about to give a view on amendments laid by other members. Convener, turning now to amendments 45 to 48 lodged by Katie Clark. Like Government amendments 21, 24 and 105, amendments 45, 46 and 47 are intended to ensure that victim consent is required before a VSO can request information on behalf of that victim. Amendment 48 is intended to do the same where the person is sentenced to less than 18 months. However, rather than amending the bill to ensure consent is sought, these amendments seek to remove the relevant subsections which allow VSOs to seek information proactively. And while I appreciate the intention behind these amendments, as drafted, they would remove provision for the VSO to originate a request for information. Retaining this ability to request information is important. As VSOs work with a victim, they may realise that they would want the VSO to be provided information to help them plan for release. If they have not registered with the VNS at an early stage, it could be re-traumatising or disincentivised a victim to require them to return to SPS to make that request. Allowing VSOs to make the request and receive the information on the victim's behalf can help to remove these issues. The Scottish Government's amendments 21, 24 and 105 achieve the intended result of ensuring victim consent is sought and secured before information is requested, while still allowing the VSO to proactively request information if necessary. For that reason, I would ask Katie Clark not to press amendments 45 to 48. Turning to amendments 102, 103 and 104 lodged by Russell Finlay, these amendments also aim to achieve the same results as those lodged by Katie Clark and myself with regard to securing victim consent. While the amendments lodged by Mr Finlay would still allow for victim support organisations to proactively request information, they would have to satisfy the Scottish Ministers of both consent and that they would use the information to support the victim. The latter safeguard was included in the bill at introduction because consent was not required on the face of the bill. We consider that having both safeguards would potentially lead to confusion and delay in providing information to VSOs. A victim is also not required to satisfy SPS of their intended uses of the information they are entitled to, and we do not think VSOs should be required to satisfy an additional requirement when their request stems from the victim and is made with the victim's consent. My amendments will avoid this potential confusion and better meet the government's policy intent, and I would therefore ask Russell Finlay not to move amendments 102, 103 and 104.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. Would any other members like to come in?
Thank you, Convener. Just very briefly, I mean, on the face of it, when these amendments were submitted by the government, we were minded to support in favour of them, as they seem to be improvements to the legislation and further clarification. But I don't think it can go unnoticed that amendments 21, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27 are opposed by the very organisations who work day in, day out with victims. So I think that's notable. I would perhaps suggest the government do something unusual and perhaps not move those amendments and go back to the drawing board with them if there are problems with them. We've been asked throughout the Stage 2 process over 2 weeks not to move amendments that on the face of it are trying to do the right thing but might be problematic. Well, here's an opportunity for the government to do exactly the same. Whilst the explanation has been given quite late in the day, I think it is of notable concern that those to whom this whole section will apply have problems with amendments as drafted. We could pass them and fix it at Stage 3, that's obviously an approach, but it just feels to me like a better option for the government to revisit this after more consultation. Yeah, in a second, but I guess the point...
I would certainly hope by what I've put on record today we'd be of some comfort. But, I mean, let me assure both Mr Green and the victim support organisations that absolutely dialogue will continue between now and Stage 3, that, you know, there is a commitment to work with everybody inclusively and together to get all the detail right. But I hope what I've put on the record today will take us at least a bit forward.
Yeah, and I don't doubt that, and I don't doubt the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to that consultation engagement ahead of Stage 3, but you know, we have to decide whether we vote for them here and now, and it would be easier if we didn't have to, given what is clearly a contrary position being taken by those organisations and the government. So it would be better for the committee to not be put in that position, but nonetheless, we will support them on the promise, which is now on record, that the government will look at these ahead of Stage 3.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to come in? If not, ask Katie Clark to wind up and press her withdraw amendment 45.
Thank you, Convener. And it would not be my intention to press the amendment, so I would wish to withdraw amendment 45. To be very brief, I hope that the government do look at these issues before the next stage. As Russell Finlay and JB Green have said, victims' organisations are highly critical of the provisions at this part of the bill, and the amendments that I've put down, 46 and 48, perhaps take a more extreme response to that than the approach being suggested in Russell Finlay's amendments, but they were very much the view of the victims' organisations that I met with during the course of discussing this bill. So I wouldn't plan to push those amendments to the vote on this occasion, but I hope we will come back to this at a later stage.
Okay, thank you very much. So the member has indicated that they wish to withdraw amendment 45. Does the committee have any objections to the amendment being withdrawn?
No.
Okay, thank you very much. So I call Amendment 102 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 45. Russell Finlay to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 1...
Beg your pardon? Did you move it, Russell?
Yes, he did move it. Yeah. It's dulcet tones. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 102 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Yes. No. We are not agreed. So we will move to a vote. All those in favour of the amendment, raise your hand. 2, 3, 4. All those against, raise your hand. There are no abstentions. Therefore, there's an equity of votes. And so as convener, I'll use my casting vote and vote against the amendment. Completely lost my place. I call Amendment 21 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 45. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
So the question is that Amendment 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Call Amendment 22 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 45. Cabinet Secretary to formally move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Call Amendment 23 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 45. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 46 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 45. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 47 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 45. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 103 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 45. Russell Finlay to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. I call Amendment 24 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 45. Cabinet Secretary to move formally?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. I call Amendments 25, 26 and 27, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendments 25 to 27 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 25 to 27?
No.
Thank you. So no member objects. So the question is that Amendments 25 to 27 are agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 48 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 45. Katie Clark to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 104 in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 45. Russell Finlay to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 105 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 45. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 105 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So the question is that Section 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So we now move on to our final group, and that is the review of the impact of the Act. And I call Amendment 4 in the name of Katie Clark, grouped with Amendment 5. Katie Clark to move Amendment 4 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And these amendments have been put down following meetings with Linda McDonald, who, as a result of her own personal experiences, has campaigned to ensure that dangerous prisoners aren't released without sufficient monitoring. For context, this amendment relates to multi-agency protection arrangements, better known as MAPA, established by the Management of Offenders Scotland Act 2005. This imposes a duty on the responsible authorities in the local authority area to jointly establish arrangements for assessing and managing the risks posed by certain categories of offenders, for example, sex offenders who are subject to notification requirements under the Sexual Offences Act. Linda MacDonald contacted me in my capacity as a member of this committee to discuss her petition to drive change in the parole system to prevent dangerous prisoners being released without sufficient monitoring. In terms of how this relates to this specific legislation that we are discussing today, this amendment aims to ensure that level 3 MAPA prisoners are being monitored in the same way as other sex offenders with regular check-ins with police and justice social worker. It requires ministers to review and report on the impact of Part 2 of the Act on MAPA arrangements. This report would in particular require inclusion of consideration of whether changes to national guidance were required and how MAPA offenders are monitored after release from custody and ensuring a consistent approach across Scotland. Amendment 5 ensures greater scrutiny and analyses the extent to which resources are impacted on, in this case, in relation to the operation of the Act. It is an amendment relating to scrutiny and to ensuring that the reforms proposed are, in fact, implementable.
Very much. Would any other member like to comment? Jamie Green?
Just to indicate to the member, we support both those amendments in this group, if she moves them.
Thank you very much. Any other members? Okay. Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks, Convener. I certainly understand why Ms Clark has led these amendments, given the experience of our constituent. Amendment 4 requires that the Scottish Ministers review the impact of Part 2 of the Bill on the operation of multi-agency public protection arrangements within a year of royal assent and publish a report on that review. For a number of reasons, with regret, I cannot support the amendment. Firstly, the timescales within the amendment are unrealistic, as we will carefully consider with partners the implementation process for each section if Parliament passes the bill. This, of course, would mean that perhaps not all sections of the bill will have been enacted within a year of royal assent. Therefore, any review within this timescale may be limited in having no or little way by way of the period of operation to consider. It is also relevant that the 2005 Act already requires each MAPA area to carry out an annual review of the arrangements for that area and publish a report. The Scottish Ministers can notify the MAPA partners of information which they wish them to include in the report. The Scottish Government produce their own annual overview report of the arrangements. Those reports can at present make comment on relevant public protection matters and could provide a mechanism for reviewing the relevant impacts of the bill if necessary. The scope of Amendment 4 is broad and covers all of Part 2 of the bill. However, it's not clear that all sections of Part 2 will directly impact on the operation of MAPA or the management of individuals subject to MAPA in the community. Such a review mechanism may therefore require areas that are unlikely to be relevant to the operation of MAPA to be assessed. MAPA is, as members may be aware, not an entity in itself, but it's a partnership made up of local authorities, regional health boards, as well as Police Scotland and SPS. They come together in regional groupings. This amendment would require that the review consider changes to national guidance, which ensures a consistent approach across Scotland. While consistency may certainly be desirable in some areas of operation, MAPA regions can at present determine how they will operate at a local level. The national guidance is already regularly revised to take account of new legislation as well as changes in policy and effective practice. This revision is also informed by the annual reviews. The latest national guidance was published in March last year. I therefore do not think the reporting requirement that Amendment 4 proposes is workable or necessary, and ask the Member not to press this amendment. And I note that Amendment 5 links to Amendments 1 and 3, also lodged by Katie Clark, and which have already been discussed in previous groups. Amendment 5 places a requirement on the Scottish Ministers to report on the operation of the whole Act, with a particular focus on those two elements within a year of Royal Assent. This timescale may be unworkable given the different sections of the Act that may come into force at different times. It's also not clear what operation of the Act would cover in practice. As the Member is aware, this Bill mainly amends other legislation, so it's not clear that this amendment would result in a meaningful report. And I agree that the resourcing requirements of this Bill require careful and ongoing consideration with partners, and that will continue into the Bill implementation process and future budget discussions. And I'm not clear that Amendment 5 will add to that process. However, as I've said, Convener, I'm minded to come forward with a Stage 3 amendment which will encompass all of the various asks for reviews in the different sections of the Bill to provide a more coherent picture. And in light of this, I would ask Ms Clark not to press Amendment 5.
Thank you very much. So, Katie Clark, to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 4.
I would wish to withdraw Amendment 4. I would, however, intend to come back to this issue at the next stage of proceedings and will look very carefully at what the Cabinet Secretary has said today in terms of the drafting of that amendment, and indeed we'd be happy to work with others to ensure that the wording was as acceptable as possible to as many members as would be willing to support it. In relation to Amendment 5, I look forward to seeing what the Cabinet Secretary comes back with, and again, dependent on that, may bring this matter back at the next stage.
Thank you very much. So the Member has indicated that they wish to withdraw Amendment 4. Does the Committee have any objection to the amendment being withdrawn?
No.
No. Thank you. I therefore call Amendment 5 in the name of Katie Clark, already debated with Amendment 4. Katie Clark, to move or not move? Thank you. So the question is that sections 12 to 15 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Yes.
Thank you. And that ends stage 2 consideration of the bill. So I thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for attending this morning, and I now close this meeting. Thank you.